and welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Phone number 866-901-ADAM, 866-901-ADAM. Claudia DeFalco is in doing the news today.
Good morning.
What's happening, baby doll?
Not much.
Bronzy.
Happy to be back.
It's good to see you.
You paid a visit to a beach, yes?
A little bit. It was nice.
And you became bronze from the sun. And all of you, too.
All of me.
Where'd you go?
St. Bart's.
Ah.
It was nice.
Yeah. Do you you sunbathe?
Yes.
Do you go topless there?
Guilty as charged.
Really?
It's the way down there, right?
That's what you do.
That's what everybody does there.
It's a French island, but without the French attitude.
You know what you want in a society? What you want is people... like, if you go to Utah, the worst thing they can call you is you know, hippie or free spirit or left wing or whatever. But there's certain societies where the worst thing they can call you is uptight. Mm-hmm. You know, if you go to one of these islands, you go somewhere in the Caribbean, Jamaica, something like that. If you're known as square, that's the end of you. So it's weird because there's certain societies where if you're a woman who unbuttons her blouse and shows a little cleavage and likes to get her groove on the dance floor, you're shunned. There's also the societies where if you say, hey, I'm wearing a one-piece bathing suit and I'm going to be covered up and I don't believe that's, lovemaking is for any, you know, consensually done with your husband with the curtains pulled and all that stuff. You're uptight. You want to live in one of those societies where if you're not topless and high, Squaresville. Mm-hmm. That's what you want. That's what they have over there.
Oh, it wasn't just the women who were topless. Guys were bottomless.
Totally.
I mean, having Easter brunch on the beach with their families. That I didn't want to see. I like looking at breasts, but not penises.
Well, I imagine your experience was the same as mine when I was over in Europe. Is you think, oh, it's going to be great. Nude beach. I can't wait to see it. But then you're reminded as soon as you get there, oh, yeah, 97% of the population is hideously ugly, and more so when they're nude.
Well, and I think Claudia just sort of summed up the main problem with men and women, which is Claudia wants to see boobies and we want to see boobies and she doesn't want to see penis.
Right.
It'd be nice if it worked, if it was a two-way street. You know what I mean? Like if there was a woman on the planet who was like, yeah, get away from me, you pig. And you're like, you sure you don't want some? Zzz. There you go.
Oh, I can't resist.
Yeah, I want to taste you. Yeah, it never happens. They just start, for me, it'd be like, are you sure? It goes from repulse to actually projectile vomiting. That's the sad part. Yeah. We do not have an ounce of that over them. There's nothing, it's not like, well, the chick's not interested in you, Damashek. Well, you just hike those shorts up just a little bit.
we'll see about that.
Yeah. Yeah, hike the shorts up a little, tie your t-shirt in a knot, and make another pass through the living room. We'll see.
If you guys were in St. Bart's, would you guys go bottomless? Because everybody else does.
I wouldn't have a problem with it.
I'd recommend a high SPF.
Yeah, I would too. Just a capful would do it for the week. I'd be all right with it, but I'll tell you, I would be weird going nude with my wife or like a group of folks I knew.
Right.
If I was flying solo, definitely just be walking down the beach nude as a jaybird with one of those 70s hockey goalie masks on.
But like, you know, if you went with Dave.
Be a good look.
But if you
oiled up with the hockey goalie mask on.
Thereby maintaining your dignity.
Sure. And not drawing attention to myself.
So if you guys took a couple's trip, you could not be naked in front of Dave's wife.
Yeah. The whole thing is, I think I would be all right in front of any of my guy buddies for the most part. It'd be a little weird, but after a couple of beers in the sun, I wouldn't care. And when in Rome and everything, it would be weird if Dave brought his wife, I brought my wife, and everyone was getting nude together. That's a weird thing. And then of course, any family thing is now past weird into the macabre,
which was
with the Carolla families. Yeah. I guess it's just how you get,
because you know why? because people say like, oh, come on, we're all adults and we don't talk about these things. But as soon as you went behind closed doors with your wife, it would be analysis of everyone else's wang.
So I saw you looking at her a little too much.
Oh, I can't believe. Did you see Adam's wang? I thought it would be bigger.
Well, speaking of porn and wang and wives.
Maury Povich.
I
thought we were talking about my vacation.
Well, we were.
Not porn.
Well, I'm moving it into porn because we're talking about nudity and we're talking about wives. And I wanted to share a very important lesson to everyone who's listening. And, you know, it'd be nice if you could laugh along a little with us and all that. But ultimately, I'd like you to walk away with a message after listening to this show. Mm. Little tips. Ways to improve your life just a little bit. Things that took me many, many years. I was never taught. I was raised like a feral child, just running wild like a hyena out in the Everglades where they live.
Just not naked.
Just not naked. A partially clothed hyena running in its natural habitat, the Florida Everglades. No education, by the way. I don't know if you can tell. Point is, I never learned anything. It took me a lot of years, a lot of trial and error to learn. And I wish, I still have little setbacks. I had a setback recently, which was I got a box of porn delivered to this station. And there's been a few boxes of porn. This one made it into the back of my car. I have a couple of cars. And it was a box of porn. And I'd opened it up and there was porn aplenty. It was probably 12 or 14 porn movies just sliding around the trunk of one of my cars. And I've been looking at it for about a month now, thinking to myself, I got to do something with these 8 or 10 porn titles that are sliding around in my trunk. And I was sort of thinking of my wife. Now, my wife's not uptight, but she's very pregnant. She's got a little hormones going on, a little bit. She's a little more sensitive than she normally is. You know, once in a while, we talk about some beautiful woman on the radio or something, and I come home and she gives me a little earful. I'm going to chalk that up to her not feeling beautiful and having the hormones and everything. But yet, I leave this in my trunk. And now I drive. I have three or four cars I drive in rotation. But each time I pop the trunk, I see this pile of porn, but I'm not sure what to do with it. It's going to be hard to smuggle it in the house. I'd rather be dead than throw it away. I have a porn thing, and I'm not going to toss porn.
Is that why there's a new flat screen in your office?
No. For watching porn?
Is that why it's there?
No. Is there?
There is.
Oh, good. Let's watch porn. We got to go to commercial. No, there's porn. I know there's a flat screen in my office. Got to get in there once in a while. My point is the porn is sliding all over the trunk of the BMW. And I don't know what to do with it. I'm being lazy, but the other part of me is if I bundle it up and bring it into the house, she's going to find it. I don't want to throw it away. I'm not sure where to put it, so I just keep it safely in the trunk. But in the back of my mind, I keep thinking to myself, something's going to happen, and this is where trouble starts. And this is how criminals get caught, and this is what you need to learn. Do not sort of let stuff coast, because it will bite you. Your own snake will bite you in the ass.
Especially on the nude beach.
Month has gone by. Month has gone by, and this porn I see every day, I'm just not doing anything. And then yesterday morning, I hop in the BMW, I throw my gym bag in the back of the BMW, and I take off down the street, and I get about 100 yards down the street, and the car starts doing something weird. And it's a souped-up car, so who the hell knows what could be going wrong with it? So I decide I got to cut my loss. I turn around, I head right back home, drop it off, jump in the next car, and take off. Then I get here, and I realize I don't have my gym bag. It's in the trunk of the BMW. And then I realize I'm supposed to go to the gym right after whatever, and I have an appointment with the trainer guy, and then the trainer guy's going to charge me because I didn't give him 24 hours, whatever, and that's when I make the call home. Sweetie, I got my gym bag.
Oh, no.
Where is it? It's in the trunk of the BMW. Send Jay. He's our guy. Send Jay out there to grab it. He's not here yet. Why isn't Jay here? I don't know. He gets here at 8:30 every day. But
Jay
today,
the butler, by the
Jay
way.
Jay the butler. But today he's showing up at 10. I'll just go grab it myself. Just let Jay do it. Jay could do it. No, I'm fine. It's okay. I don't want to see you. She must have gotten suspicious when I said, you're pregnant. First time I've ever piped up. I don't want to see you put yourself out. No, I'll grab it. So, of course, she went there and discovered him. She was crushed underneath an avalanche of porn. But I just really realized I saw it floating around and sliding side to side in the trunk of the car for a good month. I was in a sort of holding pattern with it. I never did anything with it. By the way, when you have those discoveries, like, man, I should probably take care of that, there's now, it's tenfold the likelihood of you getting burned by it. You've almost caused it to burn you. If you didn't notice it, it may not have. But when you focus on it and you focus on it multiple times, it's like, geez, someone ought to move that roller skate. Someone's gonna break their neck. If you pass it three times and think that the fourth time, it will be your neck that is broken. Please, everyone, the message is stop and do it. Or is the answer, I'll never clean this porn up. I'll never take it out of the trunk. I mean, that's not the answer. You know, if it was a situation where, like, well, one more week of the porn floating around the trunk and then I return it to the rental car place and get rid of the car and the porn, then, okay, give it that week. But if it's your car and eventually you need to do something, let's do it right now. When you think of it, do it.
You'll be smote by the fates otherwise.
That's right. The great magnet. And then, of course, the comment. And I like the casual conversation when I came home yesterday about 2 o'clock. It's a lot of porn in the back of your car. Yeah. No.
I give it to my underlings.
Yeah.
This is their form of payment.
Where's it now?
Still in the back of the car. Well, now that she's on to it, what do I care?
By the way, you know, it's a funny thing to think it's that.
Hold on. The more you know. Thank you.
It's funny, though, that to think of a cop pulling you over and looking in your trunk, sir, can I look in your, Adam Carolla has a trunk full of porn.
Wait, give him a high five.
It's like Snoop with the weed, though. Of course Snoop rides with weed. Adam Carolla, the man show, dude. Man, look at it, a trunk full of porn. He lives it, man.
Dude, we had to roll a dead hooker over just to get to most of it. All right.
Tap keg of beer in the trunk.
My point is, look, do it. If you notice it, do it. And if it's going to need to be taken care of eventually, you may as well just do it now. Do your flossing so you don't have to get the root canal, unless you plan on dying in a week. And don't get me wrong. If you have some sort of tumor or something that's going to take you down in a month, start eating ho-hos, quit flossing, start slamming heroin, and fill the car with as much porn as you got. That's all.
It's a powerful lesson.
The more you know. Thank you. All right, we need to take a break. Sid Stein, who's the author of A Little on the Side, is going to call in. He's an expert on how to cheat and get away with it. And I'm interested in this. My theory about cheating and getting away with it is don't do anything you weren't doing beforehand. I mean, don't start working out. Don't start showering your wife with gifts. A lot of people call in and go, when I used to do Love Line, they'd go, I think my old man is cheating because he's not giving it to me anymore. And I'm like, nah, he'd be giving it to her and giving it to you if he was cheating. But shouldn't do anything that you weren't doing before, but we'll see what Sid says. Also, Doug, our Indian intern, is going to do his Hollywood happenings. That's a delight. Dave's got his jerk report, and the deaf rat guy is coming in to give some advice. Hope it involves a potato gun. All right, Claudia DeFalco here doing news, and we'll be right back. Tell you how to cheat and get away with it after this.
Your cheating heart will make you weak.
Sid Stein is on the phone. He's the author of A Little on the Side. It's a guide to cheating. Not bad. Look, if you're going to cheat, you should do it correctly. Here's he's going to tell us how to avoid common stupid mistakes.
Maury Povich should consult with Sid Stein.
Yeah. Locate the best places to go. Find out which women make the safest lovers.
Oh, it's only a guide for men.
Yeah. Well, I think this is a guide for men, but most of these things will translate. I find when most women cheat, Sid's going to argue with me, but I know more about it than he does, so I'll keep him on hold for a second. Men cheat because they're horny, for the most part.
They want variety.
And women cheat to send a message to their man who's ignoring them. Women will say to a man, pay attention to me. Maybe not in so many words, but they say pay attention to me all the time. And the guy's like, yeah. And then they'll ask again, pay attention to me. And they go, uh-huh. and then they'll ask one more time, and then eventually they'll sleep with somebody, and they'll make sure the guy finds out about it, because they're not cheating because it feels good. They're cheating to wake the guy up. The guy is walking around. He's a somnambulist.
Right.
He's a sleepwalker. He's walking around. He's the living dead. And the only thing that'll snap that rubber band hard enough to wake the guy up is not, hey, baby, pay attention to me. It's, I just effed your friend.
Or because emotionally they're done.
Well, the point is men, as you say, cheat for you know, just because they feel like cheating. Women cheat. There's a multi-million dollar industry for the Oprahs and the Dr. Phils of the world trying to analyze why the women cheat too. Women cheat because something is wrong.
Yes.
That's the only reason they cheat.
Yeah, unless a woman is, unless a woman was abused. Like if a woman grew up in an environment that was just so chaotic that she can't help but bring chaos into every relationship. If a woman grew up around abuse and stepdads doing weird things to her and just total chaos, then she can't handle tranquility and will make your relationship chaotic. But if a normal woman cheats, it's really to send you a message. You're not doing something correctly. Sid Stein?
Hello, Adam.
Hello, Sid.
How you doing this morning?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm fine, but I guess Maury Povich is in.
Yes.
I did send him a copy of my book, but apparently he did not read it.
Too late.
A little on the side, Sid is an attorney out of New York, right?
I am, yes.
And you, well, first off, give us, you were in a divorce attorney?
Yeah, I've done divorce for about 15 years.
So a fair amount of the cases you would see would involve infidelities?
A lot of them. I mean, even if they didn't only involve infidelity, there was always, you know, very often there was that component.
Mm-hmm. And so what are the main things, what are the three biggest screw-ups a guy will do when he's cheating in terms of getting busted?
Well, the first biggest thing is that they don't establish a routine. I think guys need a night out, you know, from the beginning of their marriage. So if they ever have to cheat, they'll have time to cheat. Because women ignore routines. And I heard you say something about this before, you know, how men change their behavior and women notice.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you have a night out, you go out every Thursday night, you know, your wife's going to say, have a nice night tonight, honey. And when you get home, she's going to ask you if you had a nice night. And you can be doing whatever you want. Another big thing is that men choose the wrong woman. And I developed this concept called adultery quotient. And that measures how discreet a woman is going to be. And it's basically the more she has to lose. So if she's married with kids, you know, and she has a lot to lose, she'll be discreet.
Right.
And a lot of guys, you know, they see some young girl or something like that. They pick her up at the bar. And, you know, it backfires. Or they have sex with a coworker, which is what Maury Povich's problem is right now.
And allegedly.
Allegedly.
Okay, yeah. But it's a problem. And the other thing that guys forget to do is they forget to keep their wives happy. Because a happy wife is not a suspicious wife.
Right.
So they stop having sex with her or they don't take her out. And they come home too late, and then they start to get suspicious.
Well, I like the adultery quotient part, because it is interesting, which is, you know, if a politician makes it with a hot young waitress over at Hooters, he's in trouble.
That's but what happened to Bill Clinton.
Yeah, if a politician makes it with another politician, not that there are any, well, not that there's any attractive enough to want to have sex on.
That's like two people trying to screw each other.
Yeah, though Maxine Waters is quite a looker if you can get past the crazy glazed over look. As a matter of fact, most female politicians are unattractive because they look freaky and glazed over. They look crazed, by the way. But if you made it with another politician, then you're fine because she's not telling anyone either. And that's what you need.
New York State, it's called the Bear Mountain Compact. All the legislators, when they come to Albany, they pass Bear Mountain, which is about halfway, and it's like what goes on in Albany stays in Albany. Mm. All the legislators screw around here.
Yeah, but they have something to lose, and that's an interesting point. Unfortunately, it's tough because when you're looking to cheat as a guy, the more the woman has to lose, the less attractive she is, usually. I mean, the more the further she's along with her family, the further she is along with her career,
the bigger her bum's going to be.
Yes.
Not necessarily. There are a lot of wealthy women, you know, they spend their days at the gym, you know, they might be 35 years old. They're quite attractive, actually.
All right.
And they need sex because they're being neglected at home.
Or the alternative is if you're like a character, a male character in a Woody Allen movie, you just kill the girl. When you're done with her. That's probably not going to work out.
Sid, I think what you said earlier is key. Like, I would have just written your book in one sentence. Keep your wife happy and you'll get away with it. Look at Michael Jordan.
Yeah, it's
shopping. Keep her happy.
It's the biggest thing. And guys are always making their wives unhappy. That's what I see in my practice.
Well, also, I really think the cadence part is a good idea. The schedule part is a good idea. I took it a step further in my marriage. I scheduled, you say schedule a week, schedule a day out of the week with boys' night out. I scheduled one day where I go home.
Dave's nodding.
Well, that's good, too.
Once a fortnight.
Yes.
You and me, Lynette, for an hour and a half.
Now, what do you think? I have this theory, but you can tell me what you think. Obviously, it sounds like a cop-out to a lot of the ladies, but the guys are sort of meant to roam around biologically, and we've been sort of declawed and domesticated.
Because you guys are hunters.
Yeah. I'm a hunter and a gatherer. I like to gather porn now, but point is we're going a little bit against our nature to be sort of domesticated. Ultimately, we figured it out because I come from a long line of guys who are pee-whipped, and now my spirit has been broken as well. But in Europe, you know, oftentimes they're allowed to have their mistresses. And these relationships go on forever, and eventually the guy kicks off, and the mistress and the wife show up at the funeral.
Like in Italy.
Yeah, and I think the reason these guys stay married for 40 years is because they're allowed the mistress, and that sort of takes the pressure off. It's sort of the conjugal visit for the prisoner, so there's no riot in the court, you know, in the prison yard. Kind of takes the pressure off. Well, what do you think, Sid? What do you think of that theory?
Well, I think in Europe, probably divorce was against the law because of the Catholic Church. So the Catholic Church probably helped guys cheat because their wives couldn't divorce them. But it's true. In Europe, mistresses are, you know, an accepted way of life over there. I think it's just part of the culture. And I think we have to make it more acceptable here.
And everybody's happy.
Yeah.
Because let's face it, after marriage, women don't want to have sex with their husbands anymore, really.
I mean, that's why I wrote my book. I'm trying to keep people happy. I watch these couples break up for no
You're providing
reason
a service.
Other than the husband got caught cheating. Mm-hmm. And I know that if I could get some guy through his midlife crisis, I can also get him to his 50th wedding anniversary.
Well, that's the other thing, too. I think women need to know 90% of the time when a guy cheats, nothing personal.
No, he doesn't even remember her name.
No, yeah. He's just trying to have a good time. It's in our DNA, Adam. And
thank you.
It's been around for 5,000 years. God tried to stop it in the Ten Commandments.
No. I'm going to need you to represent me for my divorce, by the way.
Dr. Phil's not going to stop it. You know, it's just going to go on. Adultery is a fact of life.
You're a married man, Sid?
I am.
And what does your wife think of this book?
She hates it, Adam. I didn't tell her I wrote it, and so that was... When it finally came out, she was pretty upset about it.
Mm-hmm.
But, hey.
Now, how are you going to cheat on your wife, by the way, with her owning a copy of this book?
I believe that if you follow the advice in my book, you'll still be able to get away with it, even if the wife reads it, because she's going to be happy at home.
Well, give us another couple of tips.
Always use cash. You know, because credit cards leave an electronic trail. Mm-hmm. I have a thing called the 50-mile radius rule. Mm-hmm. You know, don't cheat too close to home because you might get spotted walking out of a hotel, the no-tell motel. You always have to be careful where you go.
Where should you go?
50-mile, 5-0, leave town?
Out of the way place. You know, like a no-tell motel off the beaten track where you're not going to run into anybody. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to be 50 miles away, but it's more of a concept, you know, that you're going where no one's going to spot you.
Mm-hmm.
don't bring souvenirs home. So many guys bring souvenirs, you know, matchbooks, or some guys take pictures, or a napkin from a bar.
Herpes.
They do all kinds of ridiculous things.
Right.
Or they bring gonorrhea home instead of a tennis bracelet. You know,
right.
I've had clients who have come to me with STDs because their husbands didn't use a condom.
Right.
Or you have to be careful with your cell phone, with your computer.
Yeah, it seems
everything needs to be password protected.
Seems like a fair amount of guys get busted with the cell phone and with the emails and that kind of stuff.
They're very stupid about it because it's really easy to password protect your cell phone or your computer,
mm-hmm.
and they don't. And wives find out, they leave their computer on or they save their password for their email account.
I always argue that when the guy leaves the computer on with the email that's very graphic, that somehow he's asking to get out of the relationship.
There are husbands like that. There are guys who cheat because they're looking for someone new, and if they get caught, they don't really care because, you know, they really wanted to end the relationship. But there are a lot of guys who love their wives
right.
and just mess up.
All right, so the big beats are: get out of town, don't bring home any souvenirs, use cash, do it with somebody who has something to lose. You don't want that crazy 19-year-old getting drunk and coming over to your house and confronting your wife when you're at work, right?
You don't want that, and that happens, you know.
Where do you find somebody who wants to cheat?
Well, there are people on the internet. You know, if you do have a night out, you might meet someone at a bar.
Uh-huh.
You know, you might meet some woman who's out with her friends, you know, for a ladies' night out. So it is possible.
What about if you're wearing, should you take your wedding ring off if you want to cheat, or should you let them know?
Or is it some sort of woman who likes the married man, the forbidden fruit?
Or
well, my motto, Adam, is I never lie except to my wife.
Mm-hmm.
You always have to be honest with your lover.
Powerful.
Because she needs to know that you're married, that you don't want to get a divorce, that you love your kids, and that this relationship with her is just, you know, a once-a-week love affair.
Right. You don't.
And that's it. And
yeah.
if you take your wedding ring off, if you give them some sort of hope that, you know, maybe there's going to be something more, then that's when she's going to start calling your house.
Yeah, I think the problem is guys take their ring off, give the ladies a little story about just being in town for the professional motocross tournament, and they bang the chick and they start wanting to get a little more, but they're trying to hide from her that they're married. And then when she finds out, she freaks on them because she thinks they're dating. And then she goes and confronts the wife.
I know. It's a huge mistake, and a lot of guys make it.
What about working out, dieting, tanning yourself, plucking
hairs? Well, if you want to start working out, you know, if you're overweight and you want to work out, make an appointment with your physician. Come home and tell your wife, hey, my doctor told me I had to start working out.
And that's
that way,
good.
What's your wife going to say to that?
She'll know I'm banging the doctor.
Your wife is going to buy you a gym membership, you know.
No, that's a good point. That's a very good angle, because if you just start working out on your own, you're screwed. What you should do is, when I started cheating, I just started up the stairs holding a bag of groceries and then dropped them and clutched my heart and rolled down the driveway. And my wife sent me to the doctor, and then I started working out, spray on tan, shaving myself,
dramatic,
that kind of stuff. Yes. No,
that's
but
dramatic, but you can go to the doctor. I mean, there's nothing
right.
wrong with that.
Yeah, you go for your physical, and he says you're about 15 pounds overweight, and looks your cholesterol's a little high, and you should start working out. That's
absolutely
perfect. That's genius. I like that. That's a good, solid tip.
So we all should have a Gumar, Sid Stein.
Sid, should we all have ourselves a lady on the side?
It's not for everybody. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to have confidence in yourself. You have to know how to lie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some people, masturbation is the best thing for them.
Mm-hmm.
No, they're just not good at it. They don't have the personality to get away with it. They can't look their wife in the face and say, no, I'm not cheating on you, honey.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but there are a lot of guys who can learn the right techniques. And I think that if men are happy, you know, if they need someone on the side, if they're happy, they can have a happy home life, too.
What is the answer, you know, when somebody confronts you? Because I get the feeling that
I'm not cheating. You have to be ready for that. I get that all the time because I wrote the book.
I know, but you know what? I found I kind of screwed myself because my wife said, pass the salt, and I yelled, no, I'm not cheating. And I think it may have tipped her off. So you can't have it right at the tip of your tongue all the time. Answer is, no, I'm not cheating, even when we're making love.
The cardinal rule of adultery is deny. You have to say no.
No, like, and I agree. Most women want to believe the truth, and I'm not the truth. They want to believe what you're saying is the truth. I think women will probably question themselves a little more than a man would. I think if a man thinks you're cheating and he's decided you're cheating, then he's going to investigate and tell. You know what I mean? Like women, here's the difference between men and women. If Dave and I, and Jimmy Kimmel and I have done this 1,000 times, and so Dave and I and everyone else, if we get into some argument like, hey man, that song sung by Blue Oyster Cult, oh no it isn't, that's a Zeppelin song, it will never leave it at that. There's going to have to be a bet made. Someone's going to have to get on a computer. We're going to have to settle it. Women can get into a little dispute and let it go. I think a woman could think you're doing something. You could talk her out of it and let it go. Whereas a guy might hire somebody to follow you. He's got to prove to himself that he's not crazy, that he's right. So I agree if you lie, it's good. But do you have any specific ones? Because I know, like, if you say, I am 1,000,000% not cheating on you, then it sounds like you're cheating.
Well, you always have to have a cover story before you go out. You know, when I say, like, I recommend, like, going out on a Thursday night, picking a bar where there might be a band. I call them cover bands, not because they play cover music, but they're your cover story.
Right.
You know, you have to come home with alibis. You have to, you know, as if you had some itinerary for your night out. You know, you have to be ready to give that to your wife.
Know something.
And you have to be ambiguous.
Right.
You know, like if you're a robber, you know, and you get caught, you need a really solid, hard alibi.
Yeah.
But if you're cheating, you want to be ambiguous. So maybe you were at the Bayou Cafe and then you went over to some other bar.
How about
be floating around.
Sid, how about others? Because it would seem like, you know, the problem with the boys' night out is you do that thing where you're like, yeah, me and Damashek were over at the bar over there seeing the cover band, and then she may get on the phone with the guy you've brought into this little lie.
Well, if you ever do boys' night out, then that boy's got to know what you're up to.
Gotta
it's
be
much
on the
better
same
to go
page.
Out just on your own, not call it a boys' night out. I mean,
right.
That's why I recommend going to see a band, because everybody loves music.
I know, but doesn't
you know?
It
so
seem
you just...
you
show up and you have friends at the bar who, you know, are already there,
all right,
regulars who you see week after week. It doesn't really have to be a boys' night out.
Right, it is a little suspicious saying you're heading out solo.
You know, well, what if it's Monday night football and, you know, the same guys are going to be there,
right,
you know, every week?
Yeah, you're sort of like Archie Bunker heading over to Kelsey's.
Hey, you here's know, another thing. Women,
I still label that as pathetic, though, as a guy, if you can't scrounge together another set of nuts to go out with you and watch a little Monday night football. You are a loser.
Yeah,
living alone.
There are a lot of them around.
Yeah,
but,
all right.
Right.
Women smell another woman on their man, don't they? Mm.
They do, and I always recommend that you have to tell your lover to lay off the perfume, you know, because, you know, if you go home to your wife smelling differently, she's going to want to know who you're sleeping with.
I'll swing by the coin-op car,
you know,
wash
so
and get
makeup
myself a good...
you have to watch out for, perfume, and everything has fragrance, body lotion, hand lotion, you name it. You have to be careful, and you have to be honest with your lover. You say, look, if you want this relationship to continue, you have to lay off the perfume. You have to be brutally honest. I mean, if you're giving her something she wants, then she has to, you know, play along and stick to the agenda.
And let's not forget the important chapter 8, which is always douse the junk in the sink before you make your way home.
Yeah,
that's
absolutely.
The entire chapter on washing your junk in a motel sink.
And making sure that you don't use some soap that has a fragrance which is different from the soap you use at home.
Oh, interesting.
You know, like Irish Spring. You know,
right.
If that's what's there,
yeah, well,
you go home smelling like a leprechaun, you're screwed.
I got... I got my wife beat on that one because I don't use soap at home.
Sid, you need some sort of protective encasing for your book, because if the book is found laying around the house,
it's a good point.
The old lady's going to know something's afoot. You need to fight, you know, like those rocks, those fake rocks you put outside the house that hide the key. Right. You need something like this inside.
I thought about that, and I actually thought maybe I could have a decoy cover.
Oh, I have an idea.
Can get away with reading the book. He's never going to get away with it.
Well, it's a good point. A good point.
Much of a loser. Take it to the office, your place of work. You know, it's not that long a book.
Put it in the trunk of the car. The old lady will never find it there. Yeah. No, I agree. Or I was thinking you could disguise it as a safe. Because sometimes there's those books you open up, and as it turns out, they're just hollowed out, and you keep money in there. Why not turn it around? I got to think that one out a little bit, but you know what I'm saying. All right, Sid, I want to thank you for being part of the program, Sid Stein.
Thank you for having me on. It was a great time.
A little on the side. It's a men's how-to guide to cheating. Jay's been cheating for a while. Jay?
Yeah.
You've cheated for how long?
Well, I've been married about 6 years, and probably about five of it.
About five of it.
Yeah. Well, I was a real shy guy growing up, and never one with the ladies, and didn't know how to talk to them. And after I got married, you know, my wife was my first, and discovered, you know, the sex started dwindling real fast. And I just happened to be going to a college and met up with an old friend. One thing led to another, and by about the third time of going to her house, I thought she was single. You know, I heard her husband left her, and come to find out, one thing he was mentioning is make sure what they got to lose. She had a kid and a husband, but she didn't want him no more. So she left clues. I covered my tracks, but she left clues. So
she
almost got caught.
Right. So an interesting point, which is one I brought up earlier, which is oftentimes when women cheat, it's to send a message. And how do you send a message if the woman never finds out? Hence, she's going to make sure the husband finds out, which then drags you into it. And for a guy, that can be dangerous. I mean, you can take a bullet.
Cops came out.
Wow.
Cops came out because he wanted to take me out in a parking lot.
Right. Now, how is it that your wife never found out about this when this guy was causing such a commotion?
Well, there was no proof. He said that he saw my name on caller ID. I said it was a bunch of baloney, and he's got an attitude, and he was a jerk anyways. He wasn't acting very nice, and so he was telling everybody off. And so my wife, I finally just convinced her. The other thing was, lie.
Yeah.
Never happened. You don't know him. He's making it all up. Never happened.
Yeah.
And so then since then, I calmed down for about a year, and then I realized that different women have different things to offer. So I started dabbling in a little bit of this and a little bit of that. I try to calm down now more.
Yeah. Where do you find these women?
It just happens. One was at work, girl I worked with at a big place where I work, and just happened to run into her a lot. And one time was at school. College is a good place to pick up chicks.
Yeah. But they know you're hitched?
Yeah, you know, I never really hit it. I don't always wear my ring. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Most of them, that's what they want, because it's the other way around with them. They don't want some crazy sex scene guy at their door every 5 minutes.
That's not safe, you know? Though, cheating at work, right?
Well,
no, that's true.
It's like
that's
taking
true.
A dump where you eat.
Oh, Claudia,
that's what they
we
say.
Won't know until we try.
No, it's not that bad. It can be, but...
Yeah, but when you're over her and she's over you, then you got to face her the next day, and then the next day, and the next day.
Well, you know, the thing is, you make it clear, this is not a relationship, this is sex.
Yeah, but the other thing, too, is there's no job I've ever had where after 6 months of working there, I didn't hate at least five people. Why not make it six? At least it would have been fun if I'd banged one of them. I mean, all work is some place you don't really want to go for a certain amount of money to hang out with a bunch of people you never want to see outside of the building. So who cares if there's a little bad blood between you and the receptionist?
Exactly.
I mean, Damashek, you hated everyone over at Kimmel, or they hated you. I mean, the half that you didn't hate hated you.
They did?
Oh, I mean, we talked about this.
I thought I was pretty popular.
Well, Dave, I mean, you got to understand that, you know, with your, I mean, just the way I did, I thought I was okay with you.
Did people talk about me behind my back?
You shouldn't ask who, you should ask what floor. I mean, if it's the fourth floor, the sixth floor, fifth floor didn't have a beef with you, but that was that internet company.
I try so hard, dude.
Nah, I mean, look, you know, people. Sal, cousin Sal thought you were fine.
Well, but nobody else?
There was that guy who just wrote on the show for like a week. I can't remember his name. He didn't seem to have a beef with you, but I guess he didn't know you.
Good guy.
Yeah. Anyway, listen, a stupid example. The point is, yeah, you know, people act like you work, like your work. First off, you get a new job every 2.5 years anyway, number one. Number two, there's always your boss, and there's always some idiot over in the van pool, and there's always some J.O. who you see at the stall in the bathroom and stuff. Half the people, look, half the people around here you could do without, right? It'd be fun if you banged them. That's all I'm saying. All right, we got to take a break. The more you know. Thank you. We'll take a quick break. We got news. We got sports. We got Doug, the intern. He's Indian, but you wouldn't know it from talking to him. You wouldn't know it from listening to him. Dave's got his jerk report. Perhaps I'll be added to that list. Deaf rat guy coming up. Henry Phillips, comedian, coming in studio. All after this.
Russell and I have been living together for 2 years. The problem is, he and his best friend Whitney have been emailing back and forth, and I have discovered some things I'm not comfortable with. Russell uses my pet names with Whitney and says he would be lost without her and that he loves her. I know they aren't having sex, but their email suggests that he's cheating on me emotionally. I love Russell and don't want to lose him, but I can't handle this anymore. Please help me. Devastated in Iowa.
They're devastated. It appears Whitney is carrying a torch for Russell, and he has a soft spot for it, too. My advice is stop hiding the fact that you've seen the emails and clear the air. Make the email Exhibit A. Tell him you snooped because you feel threatened. And then cross your fingers. Russell's response will tell you where you and your relationship stand with him.
Free advice from heavyweight champion James Lights Out Tony.
Well, we have intern Doug. He's Indian. He is not American Indian, Eastern Indian. He's going to be doing this Hollywood Happenings report.
I bet he's got something to say about Povich. Thank goodness, by the way, for the likes of Lights Out Tony in this stormy world we live in. Maury Povich can't keep his mitts off his employees.
Wow. Allegedly.
Allegedly. Dave's got his jerk report. He may have just added Povich to that. Deaf rat guy coming in. He's going to give out some. He's going to dispatch some advice with a potato gun.
This is an important show today.
It really is.
With these revelations about Povich, and of course maybe you heard about Keith Hernandez a couple days ago making comments about the ladies. We need some counseling. Our society needs to be healed.
We really do need healing.
I thought that's what Maury did all these years with all the paternity
tests.
That's why
it hurts so much.
Mark?
Yes,
Mark the poet is on the phone. Go ahead, Mark.
Claudia, I got a limerick for you.
Uh-oh.
Here it goes. Anything for love was a drama. A cure for the single life trauma. Is DeFalco's dad in the mob? I need a big, fat, obnoxious job. How about we go and whack Osama?
Not bad. Still sounds more like beat poetry than it does a limerick, but not bad, Mark.
Yeah.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you. Would you mind if I said my last name?
No, not at all.
You stinker, you, Adam.
You say it to yourself. All right, let's go. Mark, go ahead.
Brubach, B-R-U-B-A-C-K, because Mark the poet. But if you Google Mark Brubach, you'll get about 11,000 hits.
All right. So,
thanks, Adam.
Like the great Redford prison film from the late 70s,
close.
Early 80s.
Yeah.
Is that something else?
Brubaker.
Brubaker. Oh, no, like the great quartet, the jazz quartet.
Yeah, well, with an A instead of an E.
Oh, okay. All right, well, I'm hovering around the target, even if I'm not hitting it.
Well, my cousin Brandon in Harrisburg, PA, who listens online, not a fan of Mark the Poet. I think he got a graduate degree in poetry or in literature or something like that, so he dashes
your cousin.
My cousin did, in creative writing.
Mm-hmm.
He writes, he's already got the limerick about Mark the Poet. If only Mark the Poet would die, I could quit giving him the stink eye. I could tell my best friend it was me who put an end to that douchebag on Carolla with the bad poetry supply.
Wow, I like the way he works supplying. Solid.
Everyone's not a fan of Brubaker.
We were talking about cheating earlier. It reminded me of a story. I don't want to mention any names, get anyone into trouble. But I will say that I remember a story coming out of one of the juggies from the Man Show. So you can at least picture it's a very attractive woman. Now, we had quite a few over the years. One of the juggies once said that she got busted for cheating by her boyfriend because her boyfriend, after she was out cheating with the other guy, found a piece of a condom in her.
Ugh.
Oh.
I'm just saying, you want to talk about tough to explain away. You know what I mean? Especially since you guys weren't using condoms together. I mean, there's certain things, even smelling a perfume. Sometimes you just have to bite a bullet and say you got a lap dance. What are you going to do? You know, lesser of two evils kind of thing. But when they physically find a piece of condom inside of you, what are you going to do about that?
It was there from last week with you?
No, but they don't use one.
Oh.
What do you got?
Juggy's cavernous vagina.
What would you
Who
do?
Who knows what else, what other treasures
I
can
would
be found?
Say,
according to Sid, deny, deny, deny.
I would say you might be able to cover it if, now again, it's one of those things where you're trying to get off on murder. So you say, look, I burnt down the building trying to do insurance fraud, but I didn't kill anybody. That, you know what I mean? There comes a part where you have to plead to a lesser crime. Still worth it. Mm. I might say that I was going at myself with something from the produce department and didn't want to get a yeast infection. You would think you're dealing with somebody who's, you know, socially bent, but
that's right.
Still,
I just it's funny. I just was talking to somebody, a guy who's had bouts with some crack addiction, you know, and he once called me up on the telephone in the wee hours of the a.m. and said, hey, I need to borrow some money. I need to borrow $200 or whatever. Middle of the night, please, but I need it right now. Mm-hmm. So I was like, I was naive. I didn't know
what it was.
First
off, how did he get you on the phone?
Well, it's funny because I told him that I think that that call several years back is what scared me off ever.
The reason why we've never been able to communicate over the phone.
Exactly. But this is a 1:30, 2 in the a.m., whatever. Mm-hmm. I get a phone call. I need money fast. Please meet me at this place. Meet me at Cabela. So I drive over there. I don't know what's going on. I drive him over. I have $200. He says, I've been gambling.
Mm-hmm.
And I lost $200 in a poker game. These guys are going to hurt me if I don't pay $200. I'm naive enough. I believe it. Whatever.
Right.
But I said to him, but in fact, what he really did was take that money and go and buy some crack with it. But I said, wow, you really bottomed out when your lie is, I'm going to have my legs broken for gambling. When that's your out. That's the sweeter story of the two.
But oftentimes a better choice than saying, you know, I need to buy a new suit to accept the Nobel Peace Prize, when you're never going to believe from, I know who you're talking about. I'm saying it's probably better, and it's better with the cops, too, than saying I was volunteering over at the children's shelter. Is not going to, they're not going to believe that as much as, okay, I burnt the place down, but I didn't kill the body that's inside the burnt down barn. That's all I'm saying. Sometimes it's even smarter, and it worked on you.
The juggie, right, yeah, it did, and so what you're saying is that the juggie should say, I mean, you just got to bite the bullet to some extent and say, yeah, I had a
I raped myself with a mop handle.
Right. I had a bottle of V8 in my vagina and a little piece of plastic.
Dave,
broke
this
off.
Isn't about you.
Or Brusca.
All right. We need to.
Yes. I'm sorry. I got to ask because we've been here for an hour.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you have your underwear by your coffee over there? Because we're all wondering. There's like a huge pink elephant in the room and nobody's talking about it.
Yeah. Yeah, well, okay, why do I have my underwear here? Well, I'm not proud of this, but what happened? Where do I begin? I'm shooting something tomorrow. I'm doing Kimmel Thursday night. I'm shooting something tomorrow where I'm essentially going to be...
Doing Kimmel, in other words, meaning that you're going to be his television show.
Yes. Because for me, especially, it can get confusing. Yes.
Right, we just learned how to do the show on Thursday and doing
Kimmel.
This is not
over
a
the
good,
weekend.
We just learned how to commit adultery and keep it secret. Broadcasting on the air, you're about to do Kimmel is not secretive.
I will be doing the Jimmy Kimmel TV show on Thursday. We're doing a bit that we're filming on Wednesday where I'm essentially supposed to be nude the entire time, like running around in my little dance skins, and then they blur it out. But anyway, I'm going to be in essentially Speedos the entire time. So I was taking a look at myself yesterday, and I thought, boy, are you pasty, Carolla. I've been in the sun in like 4 years. And so I'm saying to my wife, Jesus, I'm pasty albino white. And she said, well, come to my salon and get one of those spray tans. And I said, I don't know about that. And
they're
she
great.
Said, yeah, no, they'll just do a little whatever, make you look a little bit darker. You look better on camera. I said, all right.
You've got to be kidding me.
I'll try that out.
They're
You're
amazing.
Getting a fake tan.
Yes. Yes, I am.
And then are you going to go shoot another volume of Dancing to the Oldies? Help some heavyset people lose weight and cry with them?
You know, I thought to myself, look, what is the big difference? I don't know. Look, everyone looks better tan. Especially when you're in your underpants. But the second part is I don't know, from a vanity standpoint, is there a big difference between you lying by the pool for 2 hours or you spending a half hour in a spray booth? Either way, you're getting tan. I've never done it before. And I thought, I don't want to look weird. I don't want to look orange. And she said, nah, they have a light one. Just make you seem like you've been, you know, back in your construction days when you used to work with your shirt off. So I said, all right, I'll come by later on today. So she said, well, you got to bring underpants that are mid-waist. You know, I wear the sort of boxer midway shorts. You got to bring the ones that are sort of the briefs, which
you
I haven't.
You do?
Well, you got to bring something that's, well, whatever. That's what she said to bring. So right. I thought, all right. So this morning I put on the briefs and I thought, I don't like the way these feel. And then secondly, I've taken a couple multivitamins and realized there'd probably be bright yellow tinkle patches in the front. Because by 2 in the afternoon, come on, it's 4:30 in the morning now. It's a long day. I drink a lot of coffee. I ate a couple multivites. These things are going to be a disaster. The day glow orange.
Underpants.
You're right. God knows that. That's just the front side. So I thought, well, not only are they uncomfortable, but they're weird. I don't want to get the tinkle stains all over them, and I don't want them to be all dicey by the time I break down at 2 in the afternoon. So I said, because the woman sprays you. So I said, all right, I'll just bring them with me. I'll just throw them in the car with me. And I didn't want to set them down and forget them, so I shoved them into my sweatpants, and I ran off out the door. And then when I got out of the car, I got halfway to the building and realized these things were still stuffed into my sweatpants. And then I thought, oh, Christ, I should go throw them back in the car. And then I was, as I was holding them and, oh, you know, 100 miles from the car now, I put my coffee cup in my mouth and I grabbed like my notebook. And next thing you know, I dumped coffee all over them. So the woman who's going to see me in the crazy coffee spotted underpants, I'm going to have to now explain
some sort
that
of
one.
Infection or
right.
Something.
Then I brought them in. Always running late, of course, threw them down on the console and then quickly knocked my water over onto them and caused the mess that you see here. So now I'm hanging them out to dry.
But the upshot is Adam Carolla is going in to get fake tanned.
Mm-hmm.
So what are you saying? You're not wearing anything right now?
I feel like Phil Leotardo talking about Johnny Sack.
Yeah. All right. Do we have that? Be nice.
My estimation of Adam Carolla has gone down as a man.
Well, I didn't really, you know, I've never really considered it, but I did understand. There's two things you have to understand. They first keep telling you how bad the sun is for you, and the bottom line is if you haven't been in it. I mean, if your chest, back, belly, or whatever has not seen the light of day in 5 years, it ain't pretty.
No.
It isn't, and I wouldn't be pretty anyway, but now I'm really not pretty. And I thought, I'm going to be in my underpants for 3 hours.
But what are you wearing right now?
I think I'm wearing my midway. I'm wearing my regular midway.
No, don't show us.
Yeah, and that's the way to go, by the way, everybody. The boxer trunks are no good because they're loose, they ride up you, and the fly is perpetually open, and your ding-a-ling pops out of the fly, and even if it's not contacting anything, you feel it. You know what's weird? You know, you can make yourself throw up without touching anything. Just put your finger in your mouth. Don't touch anything. Your mouth knows there's a finger in it, even if it makes no contact, like that game Operation. Makes no contact with anything around. You'll vomit. My penis knows when it's out of a fly. Mm-hmm. And it's a horrible feeling. And they make boxer trunks so that the fly perpetually stays open oftentimes. And then you have to do that move where you grab and sink. poke your ass out and sort of do that move. And the under, you know, it's like wearing a pair of shorts underneath your pants. The whole boxer thing, all granted, looks great. The, you know, one time out every 4 years when you end up at the lake with the people and someone decides to go skinny dipping or something, you look good in your boxer trunks. But other than that, it's hell.
I go the in-between. I don't like the brief ones, you know, the ones that look like, you know, swim, like Speedo trunks. I don't like those. Those are what you wear.
Midways.
Oh, I thought though. I thought that's what you were saying. You wear the short shorts.
I dug out a pair of the tidy whities.
Oh, to get maximum tanning.
I was told to do it. All right. I don't want my wife to think I'm cheating.
First, you're going to get the fake tan. Then comes the plastic surgery. Next thing you know, you're Kenny Rogers.
Yeah.
Or Carrot Top.
Getting the calf implants after this. Doug the intern. He's from India. Not out here, India. He's India Indian. He's going to come and do a little Hollywood happenings for us after this.
You're listening to Adam Carolla's show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
Claudia DeFalco is sitting in doing the news today. We have our new intern, Sergeet Aluwalia.
Doug.
He likes to be called Doug. It's kind of his American name. Anyway, he's from India.
Who was that guy, Adam, just now?
That guy talking? I don't know.
I don't like that, you know?
You don't like the other?
Basically, I feel like I should be the only Indian here.
Yeah, that guy sounded Indian, didn't he?
Oh, yeah, I recognize this village.
Oh, really?
Yes. Specifically.
Wow. Specifically.
Specifically.
Okay.
Sergeet, correct me if I'm wrong.
Doug.
I feel almost like you're a little almost ashamed in a way, like you're trying to distance yourself from your heritage and you're...
No, that's not it at all.
No?
I have to be the only one.
Yeah. Okay. He's proud of his heritage, but he's certainly come over here to join in.
My news pieces today will show you the pride I have.
Okay. Oh, okay. But you definitely dig the American culture as well, right?
Oh, it's fantastic.
Right? Well, Sergeet, or Doug, is, as we know him, is going to do a little entertainment reporting for us. He's, again, an intern over here. So, you ready to just roll out the entertainment news?
Sure, why not?
All right.
Okay, let's do it. Okay, so here's what we have.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know Regis and Kelly?
Mm-hmm.
He's apparently doing his live show, and he's inviting 6 chicks onto the stage with him.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's getting them to audition to be Kelly.
Oh, really?
And she's very upset by this.
Oh, really? He's doing his live act, like his Vegas act?
I don't know what he does.
Oh, well, he's evidently a guy who sings, but he may sing like George Burns used to sing. There's certain guys who just insist on singing. Merv Griffin, Michael Douglas, Mike Douglas back in the old days and all that.
David Hasselhoff.
Yeah, there's a handful of guys who just sort of insist on singing because they're old school and they think it's what you need when you do a show.
Yeah, I don't know if this is a good idea for him.
Probably not.
But I'm thinking I might go to a show and maybe get the job as Kelly.
Oh, really?
I'm not leaving you, Adam. Don't worry.
Yeah, no.
Buddy, I won't go.
No. No,
but, you know, I'm trying to, you know, make it happen.
Well, that'd be nice. I see you there in your blonde wig and your pumps.
Oh, yeah.
I pump it. You don't need that spray tan, I'll tell you that right now. God hit you with a good dose of that when you came out.
Oh, no, I'm browner than J-Lo's ass.
Yeah, you're like a yam.
And speaking of J-Lo, she is doing Dallas.
Oh, really?
Her and John Travolta. Great dancer.
Yeah.
But now here's the fantastic part about this movie. It's going to be a flim.
A flim?
Yes. And
well, what's a flim?
You know, movies. Flims.
Films.
Oh, yes, whatever.
Films, yes. Film, it's going to be a film.
F-I-L-L-U-M.
Right?
Film.
Yeah. Right. Well, I'll tell you, I can't believe it's taken this long because the country's under the grip of Dallas mania. It's all anyone ever talks about.
Yeah. Everywhere you go, shot J.R.?
Yes. It's like 1984 all over again. Yes, nobody can stop talking about Dallas and Patrick Duffy and Charlene Tilton. It's Dallas this and Dallas that. I mean, maybe it's just the circles that Dave and I run in, but it's nonstop gossip and chatter about Dallas. We're on the web all night. I have a homepage, Dallas.com, right? Keep people informed on what's going on over there in the ranch. Yeah.
You know, I'll tell you something interesting. Back in India, mm-hmm. they used to show Dallas on TV.
Mm-hmm.
But they had dubbed it into Hindi.
Mm.
But here's the funny part.
Mm.
The fellow who was dubbing it
mm-hmm.
was speaking Hindi with a Texas accent.
Oh, really?
Yes.
What might that have sounded like?
Kaisa hai, JR. Kya ho gaya, JR?
Not since the Super Mario Brothers movie came out about 4 years after they pulled the games off the shelves has a movie been so timely. Always weird. Isn't it weird? I don't want to cut you off in the middle of your thing, but isn't it weird when they bring back stuff that no one gave a flying F about 20 years ago?
You know, I don't understand.
Hmm.
When I was a kid, mm-hmm. my games never turned into movies.
Right.
Now the kids' games turn into movies.
Yes. What were your games growing up in India?
Not like Light Bright. You never saw Light Bright?
Oh, you had the Light Bright over there.
No, for me,
we didn't have power, but we had the Light Bright.
You never had...
I didn't understand the bright part.
They never made Ball of Foil with masking tape around it into a movie.
They made Dodgeball.
Damn, am I angry. Light Bright, the movie.
Adam,
mm.
The director for Dallas...
Mm,
is Gurinder Chadha.
Who the what?
Gurinder Chadha.
Wow.
She's the one that directed Bend It Like Beckham.
Really?
An Indian. Wow. Directing Dallas.
They should give you
this
a part.
This is cowboys and Indians all over again.
So true. Yeah. That's a good one.
Thanks.
Yeah, this is...
I wrote that last month.
This is that... this is that Indian... What are they called? Bollywood. Finally come out here to the States. Yeah.
That's right. So it could be a musical. Dallas, the musical.
Yeah, it's what we love. Oh, we have the same sensibilities as your people. We like to see people fully clothed, dancing, and not having any kind of intimate contact whatsoever.
And then their blouse gets wet.
Ooh, look out.
I can't Bollywood wait. Movies are a little sexy.
I can't wait for the tree scene.
They show a lot of tummy.
They show a lot of tummy.
Yeah,
and a lot
now
of
and then
saris.
They'll even show you an elbow. Oh, yeah. That's fantastic.
All right, so we'll keep our fingers crossed for Dallas, yeah.
Yep, and then Whitney is going back into rehab.
No.
Again. Mm-hmm. I don't know what her problem is. I don't actually have a story for it.
Mm-hmm.
I just think she's an idiot.
Well, I think she's an idiot for denying that she had a drug problem. A lot of people do this. You know, I wasn't drunk. No, I was fine. You know, people say, were you high? Were you drunk? What? How do you explain that behavior? And people deny, no, I was fine. Well, then you have a tumor. I mean, if Whitney Houston, who's been denying she's been doing drugs for the last 10 years, that was just a straight and sober Whitney Houston, then she needs to be killed.
Yeah, she's
there's
not
a parasite
right.
eating her brain. Your best excuse is I was smoking crack. I was out of my mind. That's the only thing that would explain
she's
her going
right.
nuts, or you're nuts. I mean, it's like if you're doing the drugs, you can put the crack pipe down and go to rehab for a few months and be back to your normal
you
self.
Know
if this
off?
Is the way you are, we have to kill you.
She married Bobby Brown. That's how you knew something was wrong with her.
Yeah,
and that
she
was
had
her
to be high. Hey, that's good.
See, I got that line from Claudia. She said, hey, do the prerogative joke.
That's good.
Now, here's there's baby mania happening in mm-hmm. LA, in the Hollywood scene.
Yeah.
Tom Cruise
sure.
just had baby with Katie.
Mm, he's excited.
And they gave an Indian name, Suri.
Mm.
I don't know what their version of Suri is,
mm-hmm.
but where I come from, it means one that is born into Scientology.
Oh, really?
Yes.
That's all it means.
So it was a fantastic pick for the name.
Mm-hmm.
And he says his daughter's beautiful.
He's very excited about this one.
He's gay.
I also... I worry, though, like when you see Charlie Sheen on Entertainment Tonight talking about his two kids being the love of his life and what it's like to be a dad and so on and so forth, and then they just happen to mention he has a 21-year-old who you never hear about, and you think... Well, how much into fatherhood is he exactly? I mean, this one kind of got through the cracks.
He's got a baby mama.
Yeah, and the other one has, you know, Tom Cruise has a couple of kids too, which I'm sure he looks after, but nowhere near as excited. How does that work?
Some yeah, sort those of switch? Were
adopted. Yeah, like I'm going to do that with my wife. Like, hey, these two twins, I'm not too excited about them, but our fourth kid. Oh, man, I'm going to crank it up.
She's not going to be around for the fourth kid.
Yeah, well,
that.
That'll be with someone else, but don't worry. I will be excited.
Yeah, Tom's got some problems.
Yes.
So here's the thing.
Hmm.
Now, Vagelina, that's what they're calling them, Brad and Angelina.
Oh, really? Vagelina?
Whatever. I think that's it.
Okay.
They are having Vagelina. Their baby.
Sounds like the name of a product.
Yes.
Yes.
Vagelina.
Right? New and improved. Vagelina.
Mm-hmm. You get the suppository or the cream. Yeah. Either way.
They are having a contest in one of these magazines.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not a contest, but they're a poll. And they're asking you where should they have their baby. Because the word is that they're going to have their child in Africa.
Sure. Why not?
But, you know, I don't get these two. They've outsourced two of their children already.
It's a good point, yeah.
They've got the Cambodian.
Yeah, that's right.
And the African.
Yeah.
So maybe they should have this child in Europe.
It'd be nice, yeah. They've already covered that continent. Right.
Yes.
Plus, don't have your kid in Africa. He's going to step in some rhino dung and get ringworm.
Well, I mean, if you're looking for good health care, that's the place to go.
Oh, sure. None finer.
Yes.
They're the greatest flies in the world there.
Do flies go in that baby?
Yeah, yeah. That's the whole thing. If you have your kid in Africa, there will be flies buzzing around the kid's head. No matter, he could go to Zurich, there'll be flies buzzing around.
Maybe he'll be born with a bloated belly.
That's right. Distended, yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And that's, I think that's all the news I have for
you. Wow, everybody. That's solid there, Sergine. I mean,
I want to hear Claudia's news, too.
Oh, okay. Well, Claudia is doing
the
news.
I don't know if it's going to be as exciting.
Yeah.
After the break, let's do it.
Claudia's I'd like a little bit of nice music, not Bhangra music, but something.
Claudia's going to be
she knows the lingo.
The news. Dave's going to be doing the sports. Sergine?
Doug.
Doug, nice job.
Thanks, buddy.
All right. Put some more toner in the copier.
Hey, can I say my line to get out of it?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm sorry.
Jeez, man.
I'm sorry. Let me set you up. That was Doug, the intern, with the Hollywood Report.
And that's the way it goes, man.
Yeah. All right, we'll be back with the real news after this.
And now, Oswaldo reads the 100 greatest movie quotes of all time. Number 35, from Jaws.
You're gonna be a bigger bug?
Now, back to the Adam Carolla Show.
Jesus, I've seen that movie 12 times. We're gonna need a bigger boat, was that? Can we hear that again? Do we have to go through the whole thing again?
Yeah.
All right, it's worth it. This is a guy I tried to build houses
now,
with for 17
Oswaldo
years.
Reads the 100 greatest movie quotes of all time. Number 35, from Jaws.
You're gonna be a bigger bug?
Yeah. Imagine me sending him
now,
to the hardware store.
The Adam Carolla
Show.
Oh,
man, immigrants.
All right, Ozzy. We're gonna need 100 feet of variable Romex. We're going to need a bunch of LBs, 3/4 LBs. We're going to need some HDs. And go ahead and get some 3.5-inch lags, 1/2-inch or 5/16. It doesn't really matter. As a matter of fact, pick up the LDs and make sure the lags fit through them, and then get some 1/2-inch through bolts, too, and get some joist hangers and some Tico clips and some A35s, and give me 10 sheets of 3/4 CDX ply, good one side. You got that, buddy? We're going to need the bigger boat. Ozzy, you there? And then, God forbid, he would call from the hardware store. That'd be a good one. Me trying to talk him, like trying to talk Helen Keller out of the house when it was on fire, trying to talk him down the aisle to go get the right screw bit or whatever. Oh, many a building I built with Oswaldo. Love that man. Now, where were we? Yes, Claudia DeFalco is here. She's going to be doing the news. Sergeant.
Doug.
He likes to be called Doug. Our intern, Indian intern, Doug, is going to be hanging in, sitting in with the news. Also, Def Rat Guy, who's in rare form, I saw standing out in the hallway. Dave's Jerk Report. Much, much more to go. But first, the news with Claudia DeFalco.
Three men have been arrested in a triple bomb attack that ripped apart a resort in Egypt, popular with foreign tourists. At least 24 people are dead. More than 60 people were wounded. Several terrorist groups, of course, claimed responsibility, but Egyptian authorities believe it was a small group founded by a man of Palestinian origin. So why is it that every time there's an attack, so many groups claim it?
Well, why not?
Like, they're taking credit for other people's work.
Well, you know, you want to be a terrorist, then you don't have to do the thing. Somebody else did it for you?
Yes. Imagine how much you'd save on C4 and vests and all that stuff. Fake visas. Just take the credit.
they're fakes. In breakup and hookup news, Hollywood's latest love triangle included Charlie Sheen, Denise Richards, and Richie Sambora. Denise and the Bon Jovi rocker, who are both still legally married to their spouses, mm-hmm. Charlie and Heather Locklear, were seen making out over the weekend. Here's Charlie's reaction to last week's restraining order.
It's the most vile attack I've ever witnessed, period, much less anything I've experienced personally. I'm sad for my children.
Hmm. Sad for the children.
So he's supposedly beaten her.
So,
yeah.
Is he still allegedly a drug, porn, and gambling addict?
Well, as I said...
Or do we know that he is now?
As I said, I would try to play... Actually, when my wife found the porn in the trunk of my car yesterday, I tried to plea the, I'm addicted to porn. You know, it's a medical condition. Dig on this, Doug. I claim that I have a medical condition. It's porn addiction. And then we start having doctor-prescribed pornography, just like marijuana.
Really?
Yeah. Why not? Go get a prescription and get porn.
Birthing videos.
They give me... No!
Prescriptions by Ron Jeremy.
They
get you off of
it. They give me everything.
And then you get off on it.
That's right.
Hey, by the way, Denise and Heather, they were tight friends just until recently.
Apparently,
so what do you think is going on there? Mm.
Yeah. Well, that's trouble.
Isn't Heather with David Spade?
Yeah,
that's apparently what they say. You know, they always say, oh, we're just hanging out. We're just friends.
I heard they were at Morton's.
I think they should all live on a compound with their lovers, their kids.
Yes.
Right? They're all screwing each other.
A goyim kibbutz.
Okay, to two more crazy kids in love, Tomcat Cruise suddenly showed up at the Mission Impossible 3 world premiere in Rome, surprising everyone because he left his brand new baby girl behind, but only after Katie said it was okay.
Mm. Wasn't going to come, and Kate said, go. You got all my, you know, the whole cast and the world premiere here.
Yeah, plus she had to perform oral on Richie Sambora, so she needed him out of the house. I'm sure she's delighted to have that nut job clear out of his mansion
go,
so she can have a little elbow room, a little room to watch a little Dawson's Creek rerun on UPN and just breathe for the love of Christ and yell if I feel like yelling. Why do they get to see the movie before we do? I don't like this. You know, this country puts out these movies. This country leads the world. Yeah. I don't like
it was filmed there.
Well, who cares? It was. Wait a minute. It was filmed in Rome?
Yeah.
I thought it was filmed. It was filmed on a back lot, all over the place. I saw it all. Well, here's the point. We come out with the movies here first. You guys get our sloppy seconds. That's how it works. We're the U.S. of A.
We create
these movies. Tom Cruise, last I checked, not an Italian guy. He's from the good old U.S. of A. And so is the money, and so is the producers, and so is the directors, and all, well, maybe not the extras. But you know what I'm saying. The point is this is an American film. We see it here first. And then when we get tired of looking at it, when it gets effed out, maybe we'll let you IDs take a glance at it. Maybe.
And you know what? And you're an Italian, so you tell them.
That's right. Thank you.
You have the right.
That's right. I could say ID. I'm Italian.
TV host Maury Povich, popular for providing paternity tests for free, I think, is facing a $100 million sexual harassment lawsuit brought on by an employee. I think we found... Do we have that clip, Bruska? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that bad clip? Yeah, here it is. We got a bad clip.
Yeah, I heard this. This is pretty damning.
Yeah.
This is what the accuser caught on him.
Mm-hmm. This is Maury Povich. Take that apron off. Drop the chicken. Get in the limo that's waiting for you outside because you and... are coming to New York so you can get the like them. Are you?
Wow.
Yeah.
Damn it. She was wired. Does anyone care about Maury Povich? I mean, had his name been uttered in about 5 years?
Oh, yeah. I don't know where you've been. That's the best daytime talk show there is with all the paternity tests.
That is.
These women who have banged 18 guys in the span of a fortnight trying to figure out who the father
is. He's like Jedi Light.
I'm sorry, Dave, but I'm not sitting home watching daytime television all day. I have to be at my wife's salon getting sprayed with orange paint in my underpants. Yes. I'm in my underoos with dignity being painted orange, not sitting around watching daytime TV with you and the ladies who lunch.
Well, as we discussed, I feel like on one hand, this woman is bringing this big lawsuit against him because she's a disgruntled employee and she's a creep for, you know, oh, he used bad language in front of me and everything. But on the other hand, she's also probably right. She's probably telling the truth.
I mean, bad language. What should I say with you guys?
Yeah, there's a part of me, whether it's the Sheen or the Povich thing or whatever, I always believe they did it. I still don't like the person for suing them or bringing it to the light of day. But usually they don't fabricate things out of whole cloth. You know that part where women say, the guy cornered me in the copier room and he exposed himself to me? And you think about all this stuff and you think, imagine if he never did it. You know what I mean? How outrageous this would be, and would you even think of it? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I mean, imagine if Angie, one of our producers, Angie, just said, yeah, Adam cornered me in the room and he exposed himself and I never even been in that room. First off, how far do you think you could get with it before it fell apart? And then secondly, you have to be insane, past evil, but insane to just bring up these allegations. I think they did whatever they do, just like people do it all the time at work. They just did it to the wrong person. They chose to speak mm-hmm. out.
That's right. The I'm more with you
know.
On this one.
The more you know.
The more you know. Reports have it that Oprah Winfrey... Yes, pause for the music.
Mm-hmm.
That Oprah Winfrey visited superstar Julia Roberts at home to console her about the crappy reviews she got for her Broadway play, which debuted last week. Apparently, they didn't care for the play, the critics. Uh-huh. They didn't care for the play or Julia. Oprah's rep confirmed the visit. So if you one of us has a bad day at work,
Oprah swings by the pad, clears out the fridge and hits the road.
Then she's going to go and console some of the families whose sons were killed in the war. But first, right. to Julia Roberts' home to console her for her bad reviews.
I have to apologize to Julia Roberts to a lot of people listening to this show, because all last week on all the Entertainment Tonight's and the Access Hollywood's and everything, that's all it was. The Pretty Woman hits the stage on Broadway. By the way, great idea to do a movie called Pretty Woman, you know, sometime 15, 20 years ago and forevermore be known as the Pretty Woman. That's I gotta get involved in a project that labels me handsome, so I forever. She's gonna be in her 90s and dragging her uterus around the floor, and she's gonna be known as the Pretty Woman, which is smart. But all this talk about the Pretty Woman hitting the stage, Pretty Woman going up, doing her flexing her acting chops, and all that kind of, is she nervous about going up on stage? And I was ranting and raving to my wife, BFD. She's an actress. Is it news that she's acting? Everybody, please. She's been acting. You know, she probably was acting for 5 years before Mystic Pizza came out, and that thing's 20 years old. She's been acting for more than half her life. She's been acting for 25 years. As a matter of fact, I think her brother's an actor, obviously, and I think her parents were acting coaches or something, or ran some sort of school. Somebody could check on that. So she's acting. What's the big goddamn news? She's on stage. So what? But now I apologize, because evidently she can't act. I was saying, why is it? Look, if she puts out oil rig fires for a living and is now on Broadway, that's news. An actress acting is not
Adam,
news.
You don't understand
it is difficult.
Courage it takes to get on the stage.
I guess you're
She's
right.
She's an artist, but here's what I'm curious
evidently
about.
Evidently, it is difficult.
So Oprah shows up on her private jet mm-hmm. to console Julia, who, you know, they are friends. They mm-hmm. We all know sure. they are very close friends and hang out with each other.
Right.
Do you think Oprah walked in, if Oprah actually thought that she did not do a good job,
mm-hmm.
Do you actually think that Oprah would say, listen, Jules, I'm sorry, but you sucked?
No.
Do you really think she'd say that?
I don't think she's that frank.
No. I think they're both just crazed narcissists, and they just love sort of basking in each other's glow. Narcissists like to be around other narcissists, to be around other people that are famous, to make them look more famous. You know, she says stuff that, you know, they say, Oprah, you flew out from Chicago just to make the premiere of the Pretty Woman's Broadway show. Why? That's what friends do. Mm-hmm. Such a blowhard.
Yeah,
please.
My friends don't come from India to see me.
No, they didn't come out here to hear Hollywood
they
Report.
They can't get the immigration paper, but you know, that's a different story.
All right. Well, our heart goes out to the Pretty Woman. Now she'll just have to go back into films where she makes $20 million for 3 months work in
that
Canada.
That sucks.
Yeah, it's rough.
I'm Claudia DeVolco, and I'm done.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one. Sports! do it, Dave.
How about them Clippers? Last night, game two of their first round playoff series. LA's finest pro team took the pipe to the visiting Denver Nuggets. They win it by 11, and it wasn't nearly that close. On to Denver they go with a 2-0 lead. You remember Shaq Fu, I assume.
Sure.
Right. He was traded some time ago to Miami. He and his new chums went up 2-0 in their series against the Chicago Bulls last night. Sacramento tries again against the Spurs tonight after they were shamed in their first game. Their efforts sure to be hindered by the one-game suspension of Ron Artest, who intentionally elbowed Manu Ginobili in the head the other day. Mm-hmm. Artest, great basketball player. Even better human being.
Yeah,
a wonderful
great.
Guy. Yeah. NHL Stanley Cup playoffs. Very exciting stuff last night. Overtime hockey abounded. There were fisticuffs, grudge matches. I've got the NHL package on my TV. It's some treat. I encourage you to do it.
What a shocker that there'd be overtime in a game that always ends 1-1 in regulation.
Oh, what else is with you? You don't like our national pastime. You don't like Canada's favorite sport.
Pastime. That's a pastime is a wooden cup with a ball and a string on it.
Go you sit play there, try cricket, to get it Stalin. Let me continue. Anaheim Ducks got game two against Calgary tonight. Down on the pond at 7. Chichu and company host Nashville. Both those series tied at 1.
Chichu!
National pastime. Dodgers pulled one out in Houston last night thanks to a grand slam from Nomar. Mm. Or as they say in L.A., Nomar.
Yeah. What the Dodgers record now? What's their record?
They're 10-10, I believe.
Oh my God, they're 500. Woo! This is getting exciting now, everybody. 20 games in, 10-10. I wonder where they'll be at the All-Star break.
You pinko.
Oh, the All-Star
coming
break.
Coming down on our sport.
I'm going to predict they'll be at the All-Star break. I say they'll be 75-10. I think they go on a 65-game winning streak, or will they be 35.5 and 35.5?
Let me tell you why you should watch baseball. Seriously,
why?
This is true. In L.A. in particular,
yes.
Vin Scully, the greatest broadcaster of all time.
Yes.
He's the greatest.
But give me
it doesn't
one...
make a difference if it's preseason baseball, spring training, what mm-hmm. it is. He's the best.
Give me one reason why I should watch baseball before the All-Star break.
I just gave you one. The greatest broadcaster of all time,
we
Vin
have
Scully.
70 games to catch up after the All-Star break.
No,
make it 85.
Every day and night. He's
all
the
right.
best.
All right.
All right. We'll agree to disagree. Snakes of Arizona.
Let me say this
I'll
about, let me say this
in the
about
red,
L.A.
white, and blue flag. And support our national pastime. I don't know where you're going.
Let me say this about the streaks and the legendary sports guys like Vin Scully. Chick Hearn's out here from the Lakers. He had a streak. God rest his soul. He was the greatest basketball announcer of all time. But I remember one time he had a streak alive of doing like 3,000 consecutive games.
Right.
And he didn't want to break it. But he was in no condition to do a game. He was getting old. He was sick. He was in the hospitals. So they duct taped him to a gurney and they wheeled him out. like Hannibal Lecter, he basically belched into the mic, and then they wheeled him back off the court and back into the helicopter and back to the thing, and he kept the streak alive.
I hear you.
I don't like that.
Listen, I was in Chicago when Harry Carey was in his last days. Also, those weren't his best broadcasts either. But that's what I'm saying. Vince Scully's been doing it for 55 years or whatever, and he's still lucid. And
I know.
Paints wonderful pictures.
I agree,
pictures.
But when you hang it up, you hang it up. I'm just saying, if I put a streak together of 3,000 radio shows, but one day I'm too old and I'm too effed up to do this radio show, but I want to keep the streak alive. Mm-hmm. So Tad carries me in and they wheel me in and I lean in at 6:01 and go, and then I split and go back home again. Streak right. ended.
Wow, moot
didn't keep the streak alive.
We'll be canceled.
Oh, yeah,
well,
no,
before
we'll be
that,
gone.
But
yeah.
still,
sure.
Snakes of Arizona won in San Diego. Giants whipped the Mets. No homers for Barry the Creep Bonds. Mariners broke the 8-game win streak of the world champion White Sox. Halo shut out the Tigers. Athletics take one in Texas. Now, what's the poop with Reggie Bush? You hear about this? They might take his Heisman Trophy away. And
really?
Everything. His family lived with a guy who wanted to do the marketing for him when he went pro.
Mm-hmm.
And supposedly, you know, that looks fishy to the NCAA. They're investigating and everything. Reggie Bush says nothing happened, nothing wrong. He's not apologizing for his family. Here's what he said.
Family is a really important part of civilization. And I honor my mother and dad.
Wait a second. That's not Reggie Bush.
Is that Reggie?
That's his brother.
Oh, I see.
I think.
Jeb Bush.
That's the other Bush, I think. I get confused. But anyway, also, you know, with these Clippers now 2-0, I paid them a visit to see who they like. I mean, they're doing very well.
Right.
And one could make a good case that they might even get as far as the conference finals. I went out and talked to a couple of them to see who they think is going to win it all. Here, first of all, is guard Sean Livingston.
Two toughest teams right now, San Antonio and Detroit. The way Detroit's playing, they're looking good, so.
Not the Clippers, though.
But the Clippers always have a chance. I got to roll with my team.
Here's Clippers Daniel Ewing.
Clippers.
No. I mean, I like to have fun, too. But who do you really think is going to win?
Tell you the truth, man. Detroit's looking real good.
Backs off that got one real fast.
Yeah.
And here's center Chris Kamen.
Clippers.
That's gay,
man. I'm going to go with the Pistons.
Good, you saved yourself. Yeah, you saved your dignity there.
Did you find any of them that knew what a Clipper was yet? Because I know your quest continues. I put the challenge to Dave. Go talk to the Clippers and find out if any of them know what a Clipper is. I guarantee none of them know what it is. By the way, when you own a sports franchise, isn't this the first thing you need to teach your players?
Yeah, I hear you. Wait, I think we do have the one guy who got it right, and it was the aforementioned Chris Kamen. Let's see if I can dig that up.
All right, so he
knows. No one knew it, but I don't have it, wherever it is.
All right.
He did get it right. You know what? I got it right here. Let's hear it.
Chris Kamen, Central Michigan University center.
You're an LA Clipper. What is a Clipper?
A ship.
Very nice. Very nice. Well done. You're the first one. You're the first one to get that right. He's the only one. I asked several others. No one had any idea what a Clipper was, but Chris came and pulled it out. Just saved the dignity of the franchise.
Just out of curiosity, if you played for a team and you had no idea what was on your jersey, wouldn't you ask?
Yeah,
perhaps you're offending somebody. This is a swear word I'm not sure of. Wouldn't you want to know? Not curious. That's what I love. Guys, the better your vertical leap, the less curious you are. Show me a guy with no vertical. I'll show you guys really curious.
Well, let's get Tad in here and find out. I think we can disprove your theory.
Jesus, you're right.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
All right. Julia Roberts, I got a note here. Her parents taught acting. They taught acting when they were pregnant with Julia. So here's someone who's not only been acting for 35 years. Her parents taught acting. Again, is it news that she gets up on stage? Huge. Well, evidently it is now. We will take ourselves a little bit of a break. Def Rat Guy.
Ooh.
In the hizzy. Everyone's a fan of the Def Rat Guy. He's coming in here. He's going to dispense some advice. Some life-altering advice. We talked to him about it last week. Most of the things ended up with getting his business done with a potato gun. Let's see if he can expand a little
Phil
bit.
Dr. Phil has one method, you know.
Right.
Freud, you know, Fraser Crane, and now we have the 21st century therapist.
The potato gun theory. Also, Dave's got his jerk report.
Oh, it's chock full.
Henry Phillips, comedian, is coming in here. We got an update on Jerron and Larissa, who went out last night on their date.
That's correct.
Foxy, intern Jerron. I know you thought I was going another direction. No, Larissa is a depends how you like them, but a solid 9 in anyone's
exotic
book.
Exotic looking.
Yeah.
Swarthy.
Tan and flawless. Jerron, not bad looking either. Easy on the eyes. So those guys went out. They would have beautiful babies. Well, anyway, we'll talk to them. First, Def Rat Guy and Jerk Report after this.
Maverick.
Can't hear much, but he can still drink beer and party every day. Well, he likes chicks, sorority girls are always ready to play. Well, Moose gets Woody at the drop of a hat, but he says that he ain't bi. Just a fifth-year senior living it up, hearing loss ain't a crime. He's a Def Rat Guy.
Maverick.
Def Rat Guy.
Chick.
Def Rat Guy.
Maverick.
Def Rat Guy.
We have Jason. Call him Maverick. Def Rat Guy.
What's up, bro?
What's happening, Mav? He's a fifth-year senior over at USC. He's in the TACS House fraternity. How you doing?
I'm hanging in there.
Is there a problem?
Yeah, there's a problem. Mike F. got hit by a car.
Oh, my God.
No. Mike F. got hit by a car?
I can't help thinking that If I hadn't called shotgun, it would be me with the broken pelvis, not Mike Amp.
Really?
Such a giving brother. That's what brotherhood's all about.
So you mean he called shotgun and was in the front seat of the car, or you called shotgun? What?
I don't know exactly what happened. We were pretty wasted.
Right. And was he in the car, or did he get hit? Was he a pedestrian?
You want the AD5 version, or you want the truth?
give us the truth, that frat guy. We can handle it.
There was, we were just screwing around doing a Chinese fire drill.
Right. I still do, though.
Mike F. bent down to tie his shoelace, and he got sideswiped by this dude in AD5.
So a guy in another frat was driving and clipped him when he was outside the car, huh?
The guy was really wasted, but that's no excuse.
Right. Right. But you sort of feel like if you didn't yell out shotgun in the middle of the Chinese fire drill, that Mike F. would probably not have the broken pelvis, huh?
I was going back to the front seat.
Right.
Mike F. had to go back 3 or 4 feet to the back seat.
Right.
If he didn't have to go back that far, maybe he wouldn't have been clamped.
Well...
Well, how is he now?
You can't beat yourself up. I mean, yeah, is he okay?
Dude, he has a broken pelvis.
Yeah. Yeah, no, you're right. Dave, he has a broken pelvis. Is he, it happened when? A couple days ago? It's not ready. He's not mended yet.
Mike F. is a really, he's a great guy. You know, he's one. He's serious. He never smiled for pictures.
Mm-hmm.
He was a cheerleader. Mm-hmm. Mike F., a classic Mike F. story.
Well, yeah. I hear this.
We were kind of giving him some hell for being a cheerleader.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, hey, President Bush was a cheerleader.
Wow.
And it shut everyone up.
Touche. Yeah, it's a good point. Wow, it's sad when a good man goes down, but hopefully, you know, he'll be back and doing a funnel with you guys soon.
I assume you and the Tri-Delts are going to have a big, you know, like car washing fundraiser or something?
No, he's got health insurance.
Oh, okay.
All right, so he's fine. You don't have to raise money. This isn't a 70s movie, Dave. People have insurance at Blue Shield
now.
That's
what the frat dudes do.
Terry?
Yeah?
You do an impression of Def Frat Guy?
Yeah, I do Def Frat Guy. I got him down pat.
Oh, boy. You this could be offensive, but let's hear it.
I wish he could hear it.
Yeah.
Okay, are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Dude, if you're not wasted, the day is...
Def Rat Guy, guy's on the phone right now doing an impression of you.
Maverick, don't let the door hit you on the way out. We got a new Def Rat Guy, and his name is Terry.
Dude, I can do Frat Guy all day long. I got wasted last night, too, and got ran over by a truck, but I'm okay.
It's a little staccato. It's a little robotic.
Yeah, you know, and maybe put a little James Taylor, maybe a little John Wayne in there, maybe a little lower, you know.
Well, I think that, you know, obviously you can do an impersonation. It's like walking with a limp. You can fake a limp, but until you actually have one leg shorter than another, you can't really walk that way.
I haven't been in those shoes.
Yes, you have. Unless you've walked a mile in his deaf loafers, you don't know what it's like.
Right.
All right, Terry, but nice job.
Hey, thanks.
All right. By the way, if you have any questions for Def Frat Guy, he's been trying to work his way into the program by doing sports, by doing weather, by doing traffic, by doing various other reports. Now he's going to dispatch the advice to help you in your life, the life advice. So if you have any questions for him, we sort of stumbled into it last week inadvertently. If you have any questions for him, call us at 866-901-ADAM.
He can't, I mean, he's not a doctor who heals physical wounds, or else he would be helping Mike F. with the broken pelvis. He heals emotional wounds.
Yeah, but he's not going to give you a bunch of psychobabble either, like, you know, Dr. Phil or whoever. I mean, he's a real-time guy. He lives in the real world. He lives in a frat house on campus.
Yeah, Terry calls in. This caller makes fun of his hearing, but, I mean, it's not about that. He's a regular dude.
And imagine a guy who's overcome. Mm-hmm. Adversity. Here's a guy who was dealt a pretty bad hand with the hearing problem. Hasn't slowed him down.
No.
If you're not wasted, then they end.
Right. That's what I mean. He has a sense of humor. He's moving forward. He's trying to break into radio. So give us a buzz, and Def Frat Guy will weigh in on your problem and hopefully be a bridge to mend the chasm of life. Whatever the hell that means. And then Shaq is going to do his jerk report after this.
Trouble at work? Trouble at home? He's ready to listen. It's Life Guidance with Maverick, the deaf rat guy.
That's right. Maverick is a 50-year senior over at SC.
What's up, bro? Woo, 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 woo.
Oh, he's pumped up about this. He's over at the Teak House. A little crestfallen because Mike J. broke his pelvis.
Mike F.
Oh, sorry. Singer Michael J. Fox. Yeah, Mike F. broke his pelvis. He feels responsible for calling shotgun in the Chinese fire drill. I didn't know they did those anymore. But the point is, he's going to make amends because he's here to dispense some timely advice to the people that are calling in. So we got him a telecom device. It's a TDD. It's a telecommunications device for the deaf. This way he can hear the calls in real time. Feeling good, Mav?
Hell yeah.
You ready to help some people?
Ready to get
out
started?
There?
All right, let's talk to Eddie. Eddie's from Los Angeles, wants to know what to get his wife for her birthday. Eddie?
Hey, Adam.
What's happening?
Get the city right. It's Long Beach. What's the matter with you?
Long Beach. Well, it just says LA, sir.
All right. Yeah, it's my wife's birthday this week, and I want to know what I should get her. I haven't got her anything yet.
Mm-hmm.
Man. Any ideas? We're going to Vegas.
Dude, get her a thick bun if you're going to Vegas. They serve free drinks there in the casino.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta get her buzz.
A thick buzz? That's not really, can't wrap that,
yeah,
can you?
Yeah, seriously, come.
Hey, but we're looking for a gift.
Any other option?
Dude, I mean,
how about a potato gun?
Have you ever considered the new upscale kegerators?
they have nice kegerators.
They have one. Then have their copper tubing.
Oh,
gold plated.
Nice
to class up your kitchen.
Mm-hmm. Put her initials on the tap or something. That's a class gift.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so you say catch her a good buzz when she's in Vegas, and then maybe once she's gotten herself a little bit tweaked, unveil the kegerator. It's going to be tough to bring that to Vegas, though. Maybe just present that to her.
No, don't bring it to Vegas. That doesn't make any sense at all.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. You don't bring sand to the beach.
Oh. Leave it at the house. Or better yet, here, dude. Mm-hmm. Install the kegerator while you are in Vegas.
All right. Dante's on the phone. Dante, well, what's your question, Dante?
Okay. I'm trying to figure out how to get my brother to finally move out of my parents' house.
Deaf rat guy?
Get him to go to college. It's been the best 5 years of my life.
I think he's too old for college.
Mm. Yeah, how do you get a guy out of the house who doesn't want to leave?
Dude, you know what I'm going to say, right?
Potato gun.
Hell yeah, bro. Get that potato gun. Get some Pam or some other cooking spray. Generic is fine. I prefer Pam.
You like to lube up the PVC?
Lube that thing up.
Right.
Insert the potato. Grab some hairspray.
Right.
I use Aquanet.
Uh-huh.
Spray it in there, close it off so it creates a gassy charge. Take a lighter. I use big lighters.
Uh-huh.
Light that thing and that potato gun. If that doesn't get him out of the house, I don't know what will.
That's right. Yeah. So basically, and for those who don't know what a potato, my wife wanted to know what a potato gun was when I got home the other day and I had to yell at her. Then it's one of those things where you realize you're an idiot too. You don't know what a potato gun is? And then you realize you're dumber than they are for knowing what one is. Potato gun. You take like 2-inch PVC pipe, put a cap.
2¾.
Sorry, 2¾ PVC, that's ID. And put the cap on the bottom of it, and you drill a hole in it. It needs a baffle, I think, doesn't it? Or you just slide the potato in?
Just slide the potato in
slide
there.
Slide the potato in there. And now you don't have to go to lengths like Maverick painting his all cammy and putting that wooden handles on it and everything. But you put a little hole and you put your Aquanet in there or anything that'll blow, and then you got to air it out so it turns into a vapor. Put a match by the hole and boom, it's a cannon.
It's great.
People will do things to customize their gun.
Right.
For example, Moose put on that glitter stuff.
Yeah.
Put some rubber cement on and glitter to make his potato gun nice and sparkly.
Yeah, he took a bedazzler to his.
It's all personal preference.
Sure. Sure. I used to paint mine flat black because I used to do a lot of my potato gunning at night. You know what I mean? You got to know your environment. If you're going to be in the desert with the potato gun, you go with a beige. If you're going to be in the jungle, you go green with the potato gun.
Dante.
Hmm? Oh, yeah, Dante. Hold on. Yeah, there he is. Dante.
Yeah.
Put it this way. If you want to get him out of the house, this is how we got this plaid skunk.
Right.
Out of our house after we blackballed his ass. You don't tell our secrets.
Oh, he squealed.
You'll squeal like a pig. You'll get your ass kicked out of the house like a skunk.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, I hope that helped, Dante.
Yeah, I just have to figure out how to get a potato gun over to Crenshaw.
Yeah, just you can transport them quite easily. Just if you get stopped, just tell the cop you're doing some plumbing work. That's all. He won't know it's a potato gun unless you label it like Moose did. Actually wrote this potato gun nice. On there.
I mean, the gun, it does not have to be that big. It can be 3-4 feet.
Right.
I mean, I think Moose brought his on the plane one.
Really? He traveled with a potato gun.
He always travels with the gun.
Okay. Oh, are you saying he got wood?
Dude, Moose always get wood. I
know. He liked one of the stewards.
All right, let's talk to Danny over here.
Who would ask?
Danny? Oh, I'm sorry. I punched Steve up. Let me try Danny. What? Danny?
Yeah, Adam, Danny.
You have a question?
Yeah, that's that guy. I got a friend. Every time we go to a party, he finds out about it, and he wants to go with us. How do I get rid of him? Mm-hmm. His name's Harry.
He whizzes everywhere after he gets vomited?
Yeah, at the end of the night. Whizzed and throw up everywhere.
What do you do with that guy?
I don't understand what the problem is.
Yeah, what's the problem?
Because we always take my car.
Yeah?
I can't even drink.
But, I mean, maybe take a taxi, but what's the issue here?
He vomits and urinates everywhere. What's the deal? Oh, thanks, Brian.
It just sounds like it. What I mean,
Danny?
I don't understand what the problem is.
I'm sorry. I he has a bad line. Let me just jump in, Maverick. I think for a lot of people that go to parties, vomiting and urinating all over the place is considered, out of line. From a decorum standpoint, you know, you don't want that guy. I know you hang out with guys who do that exclusively, but for some people, it's a burden.
Sometimes, my freshman, sophomore, junior year, I wouldn't consider it a good party unless I peed my bed.
Right.
Right. Lofty standards.
Wow. Were you on the upper bunk? Because that could be trouble for the guy beneath you.
I did a bet with Moose. Moose was my roommate for 2 years.
Right.
I said, I'm not rooming with you again unless I got...
Yeah, we had to bleep that out. But Moose would wet himself in the middle of the night on the upper bunk, and it would just dribble down onto you like some sort of torture.
And it smells really bad.
Right.
My smell may be stronger, but still.
Right, yeah.
I'm like, dude, clean that up.
All right, one last question. Jeff?
Yeah.
Question for Def Rec Guy?
Yeah, I had a pretty tough question. Me and my high school girlfriend were in colleges across country, and I came back to visit her here, and a surprise visit to her dorm room, and I caught her cheating on me with another guy in the dorm room there.
Mm.
What do I do? I haven't talked to her since.
Could have been Poochie. Yeah.
The Poochie gets a lot of tail.
Oh, yeah,
it definitely could have been. Poochie's a really good dude. What's up, bro? That's our Poochie cheer.
Yeah. What should you say? I mean, do you want to know if you should dump her, or what do you want to know?
Yeah, I know. I want to know what to do, because at that moment I just walked right away and haven't talked to her since. Should I just not talk to her ever again?
What do you do when you catch someone cheating, deaf rat guy?
You know what I'm going to do. I mean, if you see her walking across the quad or something,
mm-hmm.
line her up. Get that potato gun.
Actually, fire a potato gun at her.
No, but just make sure she doesn't see you.
Right.
And throw in like a blue potato from South America.
Right, yeah, those will leave a stain.
The little blue, because they leave a nice stain.
Right.
And hit her right on the ass.
Right, right. Yeah, most of those potato guns aren't rifled, so it's tough to be accurate for more than 40, 50 yards, but whatever.
And if you want, you can cook the potato first mm-hmm. for a really cool explosion.
Oh, really? Just really?
But it won't hurt it bad.
Right, right. It doesn't have the sting, but it makes a bigger mess.
It's a really cool explosion.
All right, so anytime anyone gives you trouble, whether it's a boss, a girlfriend, or a parent, you just load up the potato gun.
But not in the head, because you can really hurt someone.
Mm.
If you want to hurt someone, then
that's the
cool way
to do it.
Yukon gold to the temple.
Yeah. Was there ever any problem with that?
Well, put it this way. The 85s, the mm-hmm. dudes that hit Mike F.
Right.
They might have a potato coming at their temple real soon.
Wow.
Ooh, I would not want to be 85.
You don't want to get in the crosshairs of Maverick's potato gun. He will bring, it's Day of the Jackal, but with potatoes.
That is what we call a three potato offense.
So you're saying a guy spills your beer, that's one potato. Or something, maybe makes eyes at your girl, that's one potato. But he clips you with his Jetta, we're talking three potato.
At least,
wow. All right, thank you, Mav.
You did a lot of good here today.
You really helped the
people
out.
Some people dispense Prozac to cure things. The potato gun is.
If I get bumped out, sometimes I do.
Mm-hmm. Why?
Sometimes I get a little bummed out about my hearing.
Frasca, what are you laughing at? Sorry, man.
But I'll grab a funnel.
Right.
And it can fit six. We made one that can fit six beers.
Wow, it's huge.
In the beginning, I would puke a lot.
Yeah. Right.
But now I can handle it. And I swear, after I do a six beer funnel, I feel so much better.
Yeah, really, it clears your head. Okay. Well, it's important because you don't want one of those funnels that just holds like two, three beers. You have to keep reloading them. You need the huge funnel.
You should maybe write a book. Yeah. You know, just potato guns and beer funnels.
Smitty funneled an entire bottle of vodka.
Wow.
But it came right back up.
Right.
And people were like, oh, man, that's nasty. But he's like, no, I haven't eaten in 2 days. It's all booze.
Well, again, we keep our fingers crossed for Mike F. and his pelvis. And nice job, Mav. We'll have you back next week. You can help more people. We'll take a quick break, and we'll be back with not only Dave's Jerk Report, but comedian Henry Phillips is coming in after this.
Check out Christian the Comedian on May 10th at the Improv. He'll be hanging with friends of the Ace Man Show. He'll be opening up for Jeff. And believe it or not, he's only 13. How could he be so funny? So come check him out, it's a hell of a thing. He's still in puberty. Cause Christian's only 13.
I know a lot of you would think that he'd be calling up, but he calls up tomorrow. We just like to give you a little heads up on what's going on. Christian is 13-year-old comedian. Wednesday, May 10th, going to be at the Improv. Jeff Ross is going to be there, the King of the Rose. David Allen Greer, Dag, my main man. So the point is I'll be there doing some emceeing. Point is it's worth the price of admission just to go see Jeff Ross and David Allen Greer, much less moi and Christian. We have many others joining us on the bill as well. For tickets, go to HollywoodImprov.com. That's HollywoodImprov.com.
Some show, the 13-year-old who's cast aside the studies, conventional learning, and he's studying at the knee of Jeff Ross and yourself to become a comedian.
Wow.
Smart. I mean, look, everybody pretends like everyone's going to college until you graduate high school, and then you realize, when I went to high school, I would say about... if you want to just talk real college, not junior college, and even probably deduct Arizona State and San Diego State from that group, but if you want to just talk a real college, UCLA or something like that, less than 10% of my graduating class are the seniors in my high school. I don't want to say graduating class. Let's say all the guys that were seniors when I was seniors, that entire group, less than 10% of them went to a real college. Mm-hmm. Yet we prepare the other 90% as if they're going to Cal State Fullerton or something, or UC Davis or Berkeley or whatever, Stanford. They're not going. Mm-hmm. Why not learn a trade? Why not?
Wow.
Why not learn to fit pipes or be an electrician or do whatever, fix sewing machines?
Well, because that's the man, and the man keeps you down with teaching, filling your head with nonsense that you don't need, like algebra and such.
Right.
Listen, addition, subtraction, maybe you can convince me on the times tables up to 12.
Sure.
Long division, all right. If I'm in a generous mood, maybe you could use some long division in life. After that, stop filling my head with this nonsense.
That's right.
Algebra, indeed.
That's right.
What do I need that for? This is a perfect lead-in. You know what? Teachers, they're the first jerks of the week.
Wow.
That's right. This leads nicely into the jerk report.
Yeah, well, the point is Christian has decided to abandon his schooling, his faith, and his family and start thinking about comedy, and I wish I would have done that at 13.
Right. Good for him.
Yes.
Best wishes.
All right. Claudia DeFalco is here doing the news. If you hear her in the background yucking it up. And now it is time.
How can I not?
How? I know you have to. Well, I'll tell you how you cannot. Dave Damashek is going to do his jerk report. These are all the jerks
jerk
of the week.
Jerk report with Dave Damashek reporting.
Just finished writing this down. Adam Carolla.
Oh.
Just made the jerk report.
No, I meant it's not meant to be funny. It's a serious report.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Rescinded.
Yes.
Just in time, Carolla.
Yes. Let's not make light of
this. Now, I shall issue the first one, mm-hmm. as always, goes out to anyone who notices and observes out loud that this is the jerk report, but the song playing underneath is Creep. Mm-hmm. If you feel obliged to point that out, I feel obliged to say that you are a jerk. Next. I brought this up a couple days ago. Memorial Day is right around the corner. It's mm-hmm. about a month away.
Mm-hmm.
My wife, Cindy, informs me, oh, yeah, no, we can't go out of town or anything like that for the 3-day weekend. Why? Because one of her friends is pregnant and has decided to have a baby shower. That's fine.
Right.
Listen, this is what the ladies do with themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no, Dave, you're included. It's a couple's baby shower on Saturday night. Hey, everybody's going to get together. It's going to be fun. It's going to be an open bar and everything. I want no part of it.
Oh, I heard about this from another friend of mine. This is a dangerous, dangerous trend and a very slippery slope. These co-ed...
This is new?
Baby showers? I don't know if it's new. I can't imagine our forefathers putting up with this crap.
Absolutely not.
I can't picture guys with big handlebar mustaches and top hats who yelled good day at everybody putting up with this crap.
Yes.
I mean, they were smart back in the day. They'd throw a party, and about halfway into it, the men would all just adjourn to another room to smoke cigars and drink so they could think.
That's right. Probably what it's going to end up. Are you guys really supposed to be around commenting on the little pink booties?
I don't know. I don't care.
Cupcakes?
Bottom line is this. You invite me to something called a couple shower? Let me invite you to a little something called the jerk report.
Thank you. And let me tell you, I have strong feelings on this, Dave. I don't want to steal any of your thunder here. But here's the problem. It's a numbers game. What happens is a handful of your pee-whipped friends, they decide to go before you get the invitation, and now it turns out like this. Hey, Dave, we're going to the baby shower this Sunday. Are you kidding? I'm not going to that baby. Whoa, Steve, Brian, and Kevin are going. They already agreed. They screwed you now.
Right.
They agreed to go, and they laid the groundwork
Fellas
for you.
Fellas who say, oh, I'll go, and they already signed the dotted line before my negotiations have even begun,
mm-hmm.
they also jerks.
Right.
Thank you for bringing that up. I would not want to miss them with the the lethal race of the jerk report.
Sure.
Now, next person who has to be on the jerk report. This is a more personal one, closer to home for all of us here. It's Bruska, the chubby lesbian, for yelling at everyone. He makes people cry. He makes people feel bad about themselves. I don't know what gives. But I want you, just take a page out of my book, Bruska. I'm not going to yell at you. In a very nice, calm, collected voice, I'm going to say that you are a jerk. All right? Good night. And that's
since,
that.
Since I'm a jerk?
That's that.
Wrap this up.
He doesn't yell at me.
Hold on. Ryan's on the phone. Ryan?
Yeah. Is this Adam?
Yes.
Hey, Adam. I was just wondering if there's any way that Dave could just shut up once in a while.
Uh-oh.
Here, here.
Somebody's going to get... There's going to be a late entry to the jerk report.
Who is this character?
Ryan.
Ryan?
Am I on the jerk report?
Welcome to it.
Yeah.
All right.
Now beat it. Go pump your gas somewhere else, jerk.
Hey, now, wait a minute. Now, let me give my own jerk report.
Yeah.
Now, you can be talking along, Adam. You're doing just fine. We're listening. We're interested. And then all of a sudden, here comes Dave. And all of a sudden, guess what? We're not interested anymore.
Wow.
The show comes to a grinding halt. And it's like, man. So I got to change it over to the 80 station because, you know, until, you know, then something like Paula Abdul comes on.
Did we lose him?
I
think his connection broke up.
Oh, did
it? Is he still there?
Yep, I'm
Ryan?
There. Yep.
Ryan?
Brian, is he on the phone?
Yep, I'm still here.
I can't hear him anymore.
Let him speak his piece. Let him speak his piece.
I think he may have hung up.
No, Ryan? I didn't hang up.
I swear he hung up.
All right, talk to you later.
Claudia laughed and screwed it up for us. Dave wanted to screw with you.
I know, he was trying. But
all right.
And it was even boring when he did that.
Oh, man.
Give him one more. Give him a double dose.
All right. He's just a player hater.
You goddamn creep. Go back to pumping the gas or scrubbing the toilets or whatever useful thing
it is you
do.
How about he gets a shine box?
I'll go home and get your fucking shine box.
That too. Goddamn creep.
All right,
now,
Dave.
Next. Here's one that's really under my skin. This lady who gives me my messages on the self on my voicemail. You know her? This lady always is talking to you about telling you how many messages you have on the thing. She's so transparent, too. Listen, here's what you get. Sometimes you check it. Listen to her voice. Here she is.
You have no messages at this time. Goodbye.
Creep. Yeah. Listen, let me tell you something. Excuse me for putting you out. I mean, her voice, you have no messages. Oh, I'm sorry to bother you. I don't know what you were up to, lady, when I decided to see if anybody had called me, but excuse me.
It's a very condescending goodbye.
Exactly. Now listen.
Hold on a second. Shouldn't they at least get the inflection right with the goodbye?
Right.
I mean, don't you go, goodbye, not goodbye.
No messages at this time. Goodbye.
She's really
a weird goodbye.
It's condescending. I don't like it.
I wonder if it, you know what? I wonder if it came out of a country other than this country where there was a little language.
I don't know
thing.
About that. I don't just listen.
You
I don't know
no
who
messages she, at this time.
Listen,
goodbye.
Listen to what a front runner she is though. Then sometimes
what do you think she looks
then
like?
Then yesterday, I have a lot of calls. Mm-hmm. And then listen to her now. Listen to her all of a sudden here.
You have 9 new messages.
Oh, all of a sudden, she's so impressed with me. You have 9
well,
new messages.
Well, she sees you're popular.
Yeah, Mr. Fancy. Hey, let's hang out this weekend. Let me tell you something, lady. I remember how you treated me when I was down and out and had 0 messages.
Yeah.
No, thank you. No, thank
but
you.
But that's how chicks are. They see once they see you got a little heat going on you, once they see the other buzzards circling around you, all of a sudden, they glom on.
Yeah.
No new messages. Forget it.
There's someone
Ice
named,
queen.
There's someone named Ryan I'd like you to meet, and you can get together at the next function for the jerks. How about that?
Wow.
And lastly, it's time... Well, wait, one more quickly before I get to the creep of the week. The runner-up to creep of the week, Benny Laden. Benny Laden in the terrible towels. You know, he made another one of his statements, you know, about, oh, death to America, this and that. He calls us capitalist crusaders. I call him jerk.
Yeah.
Now,
good point.
Runner up. Oh, by the way, and one more too. Bill B wrote in. He said, or I'm sorry, Andrew Logan wrote in and made a request that I put Bill B from Vegas on the jerk report. So Andrew, this jerk's for you.
Wow. Let me say this. I don't know why I just had a strange thought, but We started looking for Benny Layden about 5 years ago. I mean, in earnest. I mean, we really started going after him right after 9/11, obviously. Dana Reeve was, you know, like 35, 36. She's now in the ground, and he's still delivering messages. So perfectly healthy 35-and-a-half-year-old woman who's living out here in Hollywood. She's been gone for a few months, and Benny's still dispatching the tapes. Who would have thought? Would have been a weird one if you brought her that message somewhere in aught one.
So all are right. You proposing I put Donald Rumsfeld on the jerk report? If you'd like me to, I will. Just say the
it
word.
It wouldn't hurt.
Yeah.
Say yes, and I will
You know
it.
What? My birthday's coming up in about a month. And for my birthday, I'd like, I'm going to okay. have to ask.
Now for the creep of the week.
Creep of the week.
Bury the creep bonds.
Wow.
For the 10th straight week. Wow. Let me tell you, here's the nice little the nice little dig though I can make at him. Bronson Arroyo, Cincinnati Reds pitcher, 2 home runs so far this season. Barry the Creep Bonds, 1. Dave Damashek, 0. It's still nip and tuck.
Yeah.
I got one lucky swing from me, one good swing, and we're tied.
Interesting.
You creep, Barry Bonds. You, Ryan, and the phone lady.
All right. That's the creeper.
That's it.
Yeah. Jeff?
Yeah.
You want to give Davis props?
Absolutely. L.A. Kobe's, that's classic. I love the sports he does.
Wow. Is this someone from the station?
Absolutely. No, what station?
Good answer. All right, we'll take a break. Bryce, could you put someone up to that?
Appreciation yes. for my peers.
All right. We'll take a quick break. We'll come back with comedian Henry Phillips. He's brought his guitar, kiddies. Also, Jaron and Larissa. Our two very attractive interns went out on a date last night. We'll get to the bottom of that.
I can't wait to hear about
that. News and sports, all yet to go.
It's time to check Adam's voicemail on the Adam Carolla Show.
Hey, my name is Holland, and I'm a fellow Jew, and you need to keep Dave Damashek doing sports. He's the man. Dave Damashek is the man. Keep power.
Same guy, though, right?
So? Oh,
okay. All right. We had a funny. Henry Phillips, comedian, is here. Sorry. Hey. Sorry, Henry, but we had a funny thing happen, which was Dave's fairly thin skin.
So?
For a guy who writes the Jerk Report almost every day, he's a guy who has a fairly thin skin himself. We got a call. Jerks. We always, you know, we got a call saying he should be pulled off the air. Bresca felt bad. Didn't want to deal. Didn't want to deal with Damashek. So
he doesn't want to be on the Jerk Report again next week.
He went and told intern Mike to go to the next room, call, and say you're a fan of Dave. I guess Mike couldn't muster the enthusiasm. So Mike called in and said, I like Dave. And I immediately knew his voice because, hey, look, I did Loveline for 10 years. I talked to 10,000 people who tried to lie. When there's tinny and there's nothing to it, there's nothing behind it. I can hear it in his voice. Obviously not a Damashek fan because he couldn't muster anything for Damashek. And I knew he was lying. Then off the air, Damashek got mad at Bresca. I agree with Bresca on this one.
No, I thought it was fine. I said it was a ridiculous effort is what I said.
No, you ripped me first at doing that. And all I wanted to do was really shut you up so I don't have to hear you 3 hours in the office later. Oh, everybody's saying bad things about me. I'm going to cry.
Sounds like one of the Jerky Boys.
Well, speaking of which, guess who just is a 2-time entry this week on the Jerk Report?
Bresca.
That's fine. You're a jerk. You're always a member.
You're a jerk.
You're a constant member. You'll never come
Keep
off my list.
Keep it shut.
All right. Well, look, Bresca.
Get your fucking shine box.
Next time you tell Mike to pick up the phone and we try spiking a call, really make sure he brings the goods. He was empty and soulless. I saw right through him and it left this reviewer cold. Henry Phillips is in studio now. Sorry,
hey,
I had to endure
no
that,
problem.
Henry.
No.
Henry has a new CD. Why haven't I heard of... Oh, from you. I'm sorry. I was going to say of you. Why haven't I heard from you? Henry, I've followed his career. Not closely, but loosely. Sings, I don't know, were you more a stand-up or are you more a funny songster?
Well, I just like to say that what I take from life, I give back through my art. Mm-hmm. And so far I've taken nothing but crap. Mm-hmm. That's all I've had to give. But actually, I started out as a musician and I was real into it. And I would go around town, mostly like coffee houses around here and do like, you know, stuff that nobody was interested in, and I started kind of putting weird lyrics to it, and then it kind of took off from there.
It says here you played in England with Paul McCartney.
Yeah, yeah. That was 99. I did a show out there called The Tube, and Paul McCartney was one of the acts on there, and I got to meet him. And wow. I actually talked to him for about 30 seconds, and I was actually the one who walked away from the conversation first because I was just like, I didn't want to be that guy who stays around too long and then, you know, just creeps him out. But right. It was
awesome,
really cool.
Move. Yeah, yeah,
definitely.
That's a good move for the rest of your
life. I do
life.
That with hot chicks.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. That's my strategy.
I don't
want to
be
well.
The dude who gets oral in the parking lot. I'm out of here. Yeah.
But, I like Henry's voice, by the way.
Oh, thanks.
Gravelly, raspy.
Maybe you could make our phone calls and say you're a fan of mine next time. That'd be better than the last
one. Yeah, it's been I had a rough life.
But, yeah. But,
no. Yeah, so now suddenly here I am making hundreds of dollars a year doing my music all over the place, and I'm having a good time doing it.
Well, you were on, I see here, a Dr. Demento, which to me means legitimacy.
Yeah.
I love Dr. Demento. I grew up listening to Dr. Demento, and anyone who's made the Dr. Demento list.
Yeah, I was always a big fan of the show. I don't really hear it much, but I was a huge fan, and I don't know why... It's hard to hear.
Well, all the greats started there. Weird Al.
Oh, yeah.
And Weird Al.
And Henry Phillips.
Henry Phillips and Weird Al. Nick?
Yes, sir.
You say you're a fan of Damashek?
I'm a huge fan of Damashek.
Yes.
What do you like best about him?
Well, beyond his charming good looks, his sense of humor is hilarious. I heard his sports... last year or so, did some call-in things on the Barrett show, and I thought it was hilarious, and had no idea who he was, and then recognized his voice on your show, and made it further complimented how good your show already is.
Oh, thanks.
What a fella Nick is.
Appreciate it.
Tell
us
the way to conduct yourself
and
in
listen,
the world.
Jerron, give me a warm-up on my coffee when you come in here next, would you? I hate to take care of business over there, but... No, Nick, you're a fan. And there are many. They're silent. I mean, this is what happens. This is how networks work. You know, the people that enjoy the show that aren't offended by the language or the brief nudity or the content don't sit down and write a letter. It's a handful of troublemakers. Mm. Evangelical Christians, whoever, they write a letter, they get a couple people to fire a few emails. Next thing you know, the guy's off the air and the show's off the air. The millions of people that enjoy the work, not saying this is true in Dave's
not
sense,
for me, but
right. Yeah, the bigger picture, the millions of fans, they don't sit down and write a letter. Mm-hmm. You never hear from them.
No, it's true. And you were talking about tough skin, and I really don't have it at all. And I don't know if anybody ever really gets to a point where they're fine with just reading people saying bad things about them. And I actually got an email from a girl, it was like an 8-year-old girl, who said, I really like your music. My brother's 14 and he thinks you're retarded. And I was like, she could have left that part out.
Yeah. But,
well, it seems like the opposite, though, is true, Carolla, with you. I've heard a number of women come up to you, and they're not the fans, but they always say, my boyfriend is a huge fan of yours, Adam. I don't get it.
Yeah, I don't personally care. I don't personally care for you.
Why can't they leave that part out of it? Just give a compliment.
I don't know. People do more damage with the little add-ons and extras, and then the questions. Huge fan of the man show. What have you been? Have you done anything since? Thank you for that. Thank you. That feels great. All right, we need to take a break. Henry, you've brought your guitar. There you
just
go.
Just proving it to everybody out there. Right.
Henry Phillips there, and he's going to belt out a hilarious song for us. What's the topic of it?
Well, why don't I do this one about calling that somebody special really late at night?
All right. We'll hear the booty call song from Henry Phillips, and then news and sports, and also Jerron and Larissa will learn intern love update after this.
I'm even willing to pay some girl to say that she's my girlfriend, cause all my friends think I'm gay, cause I never have a girlfriend. I'd buy flowers every day for my girlfriend. I wouldn't be like OJ and kill my girlfriend.
Henry Phillips.
All right, the clap. Yeah.
I'm hoping you sung that song, otherwise it'd be embarrassing.
Yeah, no, that one is actually me.
Henry Phillips in studio brought his guitar very quickly just because I feel so bad for Dave, right?
Yes, yes. I don't understand it. Dave Damashek is the man.
That's
I
right.
I can sum it up in one word. Choo-choo! Who can beat that? It's just the way he delivered his sports report. These morons couldn't even understand it. I'm even willing to go one step further. How about Damashek featuring Adam Carolla?
Oh.
Thank you, Fishbowl.
Wow. Give, fish what, the fish tank agrees. Wow. I'm sure most people would prefer it stay the way it is, but thank you, Ray.
Now
fish
Ray,
tank agrees.
Pardon me for tuning into your voice, but I can hear you're Jewish and from the Pittsburgh area.
Yes. Only on Sundays and Tuesdays.
Could there? No, are you a man of color, Ray?
Sure enough. I've been told once in a while I was African-American.
I'm told, and take this in the spirit in which it's intended, I'm told you people know sports.
That's why he knows Jonathan Chichi, the San Jose Sharks.
Right.
Best player.
So if you say, what I'm saying is one brother giving the thumbs up to Damashek is worth 1,000 Whiteys. Do you know what I mean?
One brother giving a thumbs up to Damashek is worth at least 5,000 Whiteys. Come on.
Thank you, Ray.
Yes, Ray. Thank you.
All right. Damashek and his mother both thank you. The Ed?
Hello?
Ed's from Vegas.
Another man of color.
There better nobody be talking bad about the Dave.
Oh, you like Damashek, too.
Thank you, the Ed.
That Dave tells it everything. He, I don't know if a lot of people know this or not, but he picked the Pittsburgh Steelers to win everything in Super Bowl time.
Oh, really? I hadn't heard him talk about the Steelers.
The Ed points out, he's in Vegas. He's a gambling man. He knows I went 12-0 in the NFL.
12-0 sailed right through the playoffs.
That's right.
12-0.
I had bet on 4 of those games.
Mm-hmm. Won some good pocket change.
He did good for me. I need some more picks.
Right. Well, come football season.
That's what you should do. Every day you should get one good pick so I can go bet it.
That's not a bad idea, buddy.
You wouldn't have to work part-time. Thank you, the ad. Now, I'm sorry, Henry.
It was
unfinished business over here. Henry Phillips there. He has brought his guitar and going to play Diddy for us.
Yeah. Why don't I do something off of my... this is my new CD, which has only been out about a year now, and it's already well into the... double-digit sales category, which is kind of exciting.
Why haven't I heard from you?
Yeah. And it's sort of my tribute to failed relationships. I'm going through a little bit of a breakup situation right now, which sucks. And my friends are tired of hearing me complain about it. It's been about 7 years now or whatever, but it sucks.
Right. It passes quickly.
Yeah, and I was seeing this girl recently. It was cool, I don't know. I think there's some things that girls shouldn't say in the middle of having sex. You know, like, I have no problem if you're having sex. At one point, the girl says, hey, I really like it when you do this, you know, whatever. But she would always be like, oh, I really like it when people do this. And I'm like, people? That's not the right word at all. It's not right. Like gender specific. You just kind of picture a big crowd of people.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the basis for that. And then this is a song that has little or nothing to do with that whole bit. But this is this is just a song, a harmless song about calling that somebody special really late at night. And it goes like this. Hello, Michelle. I know you're probably sleeping, but I just called because there was something on my mind. You're the kind of girl that a man could really settle down with, 'cause you're smart, faithful, innocent, and kind, which is why I'm calling you tonight. What was the name of that one other chick you were hanging out with Friday night with the pierced tongue? You know, the one that said that she used to be a stripper? Said she was making up for some weird emotional problems by having sex with everybody. Well, is she seeing anyone right now? And if not, well, do you maybe have her number? And if she is, well, then what are you doing tonight? Oh, wait, hang on really quick, Michelle, listen. I think that sounds like my call waiting. Hang on while I just lose that other call. Click. Oh, hey, Janine, what's that? You say you want to see me and you're not wearing anything at all. Well, hang on while I just lose this other call. Click. Michelle, whatever the hell your name is, listen, I better take that, it sounds important, but listen, you know, we should still really get together sometime. Cause I'd love to hear more about you, and besides, I still gotta get that stripper chick's number, but right now I'm just gonna grab this other line, but I want you to know that you'll always be sort of in the back of my mind. Ah, it's just a little love song, man.
Moving.
Yes. Yeah. Getting layered. Yeah, boy, that thing was a seven-layer dip,
kinda,
but I liked it.
Thanks, man. It's kind of, James, somebody actually tried to, an agent that I had for a little while was trying to label me, and they said, you're sort of like James Taylor on Smack. But the problem I have with that is that I think James Taylor actually was on Smack.
Seems so like he is,
just like saying James Taylor, like,
right.
You know,
seems
it's
naughty.
Like Ike Turner, if he was a wife-beating cokehead or something.
Right.
It's like,
it's chunky Billy Joel.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, yeah. He's already done.
Yeah, so that sums it up mostly, I'd say.
Well, I want to give you a nice big fat plug, speaking of chunky, for that wonderful song. HenryPhillips.com is where you go if you want to get the CD. Why Haven't I Heard From You, which that song is on, yes?
Yeah, and I want to say my website kind of has AIDS in some parts. You know, it's got the whole... the schedule thing I need to update, but I have movies on my website that everybody seems to gloss over, but
movies you're in.
Yeah, on the media section you can check out my short films, and I think it'll explain a little bit more about me.
Henry Phillips at henryphillips.com. Thanks, Henry.
Thank you, guys.
Appreciate that. We're doing sports, we're doing news, we also have a very important update. Jerron and Larissa, Foxy intern Larissa, free-spirited Foxy Larissa, and Jerron, world's whitest black man, went on a date. We'll get some of the details from them. I've heard little bits and pieces, but I'm biting my tongue until they get in here in the flesh. They went out last night. We'll find out how it went after this.
He talks like a cracker, even though he's got black skin. Jerron the intern sounds like Richie Cunningham. Can't talk slang with the brothers. He gives Brian Gumbel street cred. He's got no baby mothers. He's like Wayne Gretzky with a tan. He sounds white, but he's a brown-skinned man.
All right. That is Jerron, our intern. He sounds white, but he's a brown-skinned Foxy Larissa.
Thank you.
Barely 20. 20 years old?
Yes.
Arguably our two best looking people on staff.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you.
Speaking on staff, Larissa Spinner. Petite, small, that's the way I like them. You're tan.
You're more than twice her age.
Hey, this is Hollywood, baby.
That's true.
Larissa, you could get with a guy like me, right?
Of course.
I could show you.
Not really fast.
It wouldn't be charity either, would it, Larissa? You like the idea of laying down with the ace man. Is that true?
Maybe.
I don't want to get distracted. I'm sorry. That's a conversation for another time. We have Jerron, who, by the way, looks like, to paint the picture, looks sort of like LeBron James, but very thin.
Yeah.
Think of LeBron James and then look at Jerron. They look alike.
Yes, they do. But I would say Jerron is an attractive LeBron.
Right, yeah.
We got to clean up these black names, by the way. It's getting cloudy now. I have to think double time every time.
LeBron, but Jerron, right.
Nachilla, and this is Deshaun. It's like, it's too much thinking for the white man. Couldn't you guys just pick up Jack and Steve and Dave?
Common.
You really have to stop and think every time. All right. So Jerron, yes, he's a very good looking LeBron,
right? Yeah.
With none of the talent. Now, Larissa,
yes,
who is a good looking Larissa. She doesn't look like anybody. I would say if you had to compare her a little to somebody, maybe a Meadow Soprano.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
Dark skin, attractive.
Bronze flesh.
Yes.
Nice.
I don't
nice.
Watch The Sopranos.
Well,
dark
you look,
hair.
You look like
straight.
You look like the daughter of Tony. You guys went out now.
Yes.
You guys went out last night. Jerron, you have been asking Larissa out for some time, right?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. And you've asked her to lunch and things like that, but she hasn't really...
She's been rejecting me.
Mm-hmm. Now, why is that, Larissa? Are you single?
Yes.
You are?
Yes.
And why not date Jerron?
There's nothing against... I don't have anything against Jerron.
It's because I'm poor, that's why.
No, mm-hmm. That is not why. I don't know. He asked me to lunch, and I said, yes, you guys have the wrong idea.
Yeah, but you said yes. He asked you out. You knew that when he asked you out, it was for romantic purposes. You said yes, but then you said after the fact to me, it's not romantic. It's, I mean, mm-hmm. I'm just going out as friends.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, really? Yeah, that's what I thought. He said, you want to go to lunch? No, see, I knew that. God, this is a very uncomfortable position to be in.
Okay, can I weigh in on this and help out Larissa?
Yes, go ahead, Claudia.
This happens at work. Mm-hmm. Sometimes a really nice guy, and you are, mm-hmm. and you're hot. Yes, you, you are.
Mm-hmm.
So are you. Sometimes you see... Thanks. Sometimes you see a guy, you think he's great, but you just don't have... You're not into him that way.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Aww, it's not you. It's her.
Women.
We don't know. This was all before the date. We decided instead of lunch, go out on a proper date in the evening,
mm-hmm.
replete with booze.
Right.
It actually was just going out with a friend, right?
Last night was not a friend thing. Wow. It was a date, but it was very nice.
Where did you go?
We went to Yamashiro.
Beautiful. Up on the hill there?
Yes, it was gorgeous.
And an old-fashioned, proper-style date where the chick paid.
Yes. Yeah. I'm like, can I get the bill, please? Here's my
Jerron, what is up?
Wait, can I tell you my favorite line of his last night? We sat down and he goes, do we pay notes. Here or at the front?
Classic.
I hop.
Wow.
No, and, you didn't.
Yeah.
All right.
I hope you pay in the front.
So what happened? You sat down, you had a lovely Japanese meal.
Yes, we had a lovely little Japanese waitress.
Did Jerron pick you up?
No, we met here, because I live on the opposite end of the world from him.
I see, okay. Mm-hmm.
So we met here.
How did she look, Jerron?
She looked okay.
Oh, that's not what you said last night, Jerron.
Oh, what'd you say last night?
Okay, I have it.
You have it.
He says... Well, I guess I look okay, but you look magical.
Smart.
Magical. Right. That's his opening line. Huh?
I can't think of a good word to use.
And then he goes, now I just want you to know, I'm not easy, so don't get any ideas on the first date.
That's cute. That's
what
I like that. No,
what
I
said is that I don't sleep with you on the first date alone. You know, give me a couple of drinks on the first date, then I'll sleep with you.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I said.
Liquid panty
remover. I thought you meant alone without another person.
So then,
too.
So you guys are up at the beautiful Japanese restaurant up above the Magic Castle.
Yes.
Looking out
there.
Over Los Angeles.
Yes, mm-hmm. It was very nice.
Young interns on the Adam Carolla Show with all their lives ahead of them and the hopes and the dreams staring out over the skyline.
Flowing free.
Yes.
Yeah, so
I introduced him to some cold sake last night.
He got a little buzz going. And then what? Did Jerron start to change? Sometimes you have to take them out of the environment they're in.
Right.
You know what I mean? You know him here. It's 5 in the morning and he's drinking coffee. But now it's the street lights are on and you're up on Yamashiro and you're drinking sake. Did he change in your eyes at all?
No. Actually, his personality pretty much stayed the same.
But no more attracted to him? No less attracted to him?
Oh, in that respect. Mm-hmm. Well, I could have probably used some more sake then. No, I'm just joking.
Really?
Wait a second.
You know, of course, I think he's attractive. I never said that he wasn't attractive. I think he's a very good-looking guy.
Mm.
So
the problem really is, the fundamental problem here, Jerron, all guys have suffered from this before. Women can think you're attractive and think you're attractive and not be attracted to you, whereas guys can't think a woman's attractive and not be attracted to them. Larissa's attractive, you're attractive, you're attracted to Larissa, she's not attracted to you even though you're attractive. That's the part that sucks.
Mm, exactly.
Now how is that? Yeah, girls can do that, huh? Guys
now wait
can.
A second, yes. Larissa. So there's no chance of anything happening between the two of you. Really, there's zero chance.
Hey, why are you saying that?
You feel like maybe. Will there be a second date?
Don't lead him on if
there's
no
chance.
I'm thinking.
Now, you're very single, right, Larissa?
Yeah, I'm single.
You introduced him to sake. He introduced you to his unagi roll.
The chocolate man.
Yeah. Well, it's sake, but it starts with a C. Do the math on that.
Okay, another date. I'd go on another date.
You would? All right, really? Now be very candid, and Jerron, don't eyeball her anymore. Face Brusca. Fixate on one of his tremendous areolas. And let me just talk to Larissa for a second. Larissa, you're not doing anyone any favors if you go out with him just because it's uncomfortable to say, I don't want to go out with him again. But if you think there might be a chance.
If there's a 10% chance that maybe this thing winds up between the sheets.
If there's a chance that you might be attracted to him or that you could get over the sort of part of the coworker relationship or what have you. If you feel like maybe he could win you over, then go. If there's no chance, don't go. Tell us now.
Don't waste Jerron's time.
And what is wrong? If Jerron is attractive, then what's wrong with him?
But as you said, somebody can look or be attractive, but you just don't feel any chemical.
Therein lies, that's the problem right there. What aren't they giving off? Too goofy, too helpful, too young.
Maybe she didn't drink enough last night.
Yeah.
No, I really do agree, though. Women can find people attractive, but just not have that, like...
Now, who...
Then because we don't think with our penises.
Right.
Are you... Yes, you think with your scrotum. Are you attracted to anybody who works here, attractive or not?
Maybe.
Yeah, what is your type? Who do you have a little crush on?
Oh my gosh, you just made eye contact with Ted.
Oh, no, Larissa. See, this could get me in trouble.
Is there somebody here? Who?
Now she just made eye contact with me.
By the way, Jerron just whispered to me, Dave, she has a thing for Dave.
Dave Damashek?
Yep.
Wow. Well, she's not the first, and she won't be the last. Jerron, I think you have a little secret, though, that you'd like to share with Larissa, though.
Mm. No, I don't.
What happened this weekend?
You had another date on the weekend.
I told her what happened this weekend.
Oh, yeah, that he had sex with some girl or something.
Wow. And it didn't even work to make you jealous.
Yeah,
you know what he tells me at the end when I'm dropping him off? He goes, can you call me and tell me stories about your girlfriends later so I can masturbate?
Oh, my God. Second thing actually got laid on this date right here. That's why.
Has that ever worked before?
She wasn't give me an action on the last date.
Wow, Sir Walter Raleigh over here. Jesus Christ, what happened to chivalry? You make me sick, Jerron.
That's a class move. Right before he dropped me in my car.
All right, so Larissa, you're attracted to one Dave Damashek.
So now we'll go on a date, she and I.
Yeah, that's right. Why not?
I'll have my old lady whip up some dinner for us.
Yeah, make some
ossobuco. And then we'll see where it goes.
Yeah, see where the night takes you.
I'll be the chauffeur.
Oh, so sad.
All right, well, a love match was not made then. No reason to go out
again.
I'll
take you out to lunch today.
Okay.
We will, throw him a sympathy F, would you, Claudia?
Sure.
We'll take ourselves a quick break. When we come back, Larissa, why don't you rank the guys? I know Dave's at the top of your pyramid, but there might be someone else around here.
What do you do for my lap?
Okay.
Yes. We'll be right back. Jerron, you've outlived your usefulness, not only in this break, but in the show.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Don't leave without stopping by my office.
Okay.
close the door behind you. All right. We'll take a break. We'll be right back after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. He's so hot.
Yeah. You hear that, Larissa?
Yeah.
Hot. Intern Jerron, intern Larissa. Larissa, she's like a little tan propeller. Spinner. That's the way I like them. Makes me look bigger downstairs. You know what I mean? Sure. You get with a chick the size of Shaq, I don't care what you got down there. It just looks like you got a roach coming out of your underpants. But you get with someone like Larissa, you seem well endowed. I've done the math. Jerron and her date did not go well.
Not at all.
That's not true. It went very well.
Well, here's how bad it went. Larissa, please. Apparently, he quoted at one point Kobe Bryant. I don't think that's a great move.
And there'll be no second date. Not unless you're serious, Jerron, and you're serious, Larissa. Jerron, you have to be serious about dating, not humping.
Larissa sees it like a chore to do this. So I say, I mean, when I approach her to go out, she's like, oh.
No, that's not true. I did that as a joke.
She went to free food, that's all.
No.
Free food, she paid for.
Yeah.
My credit's messed up anyway, that's why.
She's, brother, can't get a break in this town.
Can't get credit cards.
They, Cabs and credit cards. Larissa already said that Dave was her favorite in the group here.
I agree.
Dave
Wait
agreed.
A second. What's the quote from last night for Duran?
Yes.
You're the air that I breathe, the beat of my heart. And then he said another, what was the last part? Was there another part?
You're just special to me.
Oh, okay. Yeah, he kept going, you're the air that I breathe, the beat of my heart.
Apology line to his wife. Well done, Duran.
And he turns to me and he goes, don't worry, I'm gentle.
Another no, because when she
another
said that,
man who's black on the outside and white on the inside.
She said she was afraid of black guys because you know she's heard myths.
Oh right, and he goes, "Don't
but
worry."
But the truth, though,
I'm gentle.
Yeah.
Wow.
All right, so Larissa, you were going to rank the guys here, starting at the bottom and working your way up.
Starting at the bottom.
Dave Damashek.
And get to it. We don't have time.
Okay. Get to it. Let's see. We've got...
For yelling at her, I'm sure you bring up the rear now, Breska. Nothing new for you. Wait a second. By the way, this is about looks, not about money or power. About looks, who would you want to bed?
Exactly.
Okay. Oh, God.
Well, wait a minute. I always feel like I have to qualify this. It's whoever you're attracted to the most.
Okay.
Whatever that means to you.
And I have to explain why. Okay. Mike, because I don't know you, because I never hear you talk. We never, like, exchanged anything.
Now you're not going to.
Jimmy.
He told her. By the way, I said you could include Tad in this.
All right.
Now you're going to hear it from me.
Wow.
This is so unfair. Jimmy, okay, I don't really know why.
Sorry. He's not into big boobs.
Yeah, she's working.
No letter of recommendation.
She's working on
See,
a
this
gut.
This is so unfair.
She's working on gut instinct, your fat gut.
Okay, we've got, let's see. No, I
Gay
like
Bill?
Him. I like that.
Gay Bill,
How about phone screen of Brian?
Which one's... Oh, Brian. Yeah. Brian's next.
Brutal.
Brian, okay. Then Bill.
Gay board up, Bill.
Yeah, wow. He's cute.
Brian, you got to kill yourself.
Okay,
Gay
then
Bill
Tad,
over you.
Definitely
I'm
Tad.
Much
Tad's
better looking than
there.
Brian.
Tad is ahead of Bruska. Michael Lynch. By the way, if you like lesbians, I'm a fat lesbian. I should be number one.
You shouldn't be that. Okay, then Adam, and then Dave.
Okay.
Am I chopped liver?
A close second.
Why am I missing four?
Well, no. Okay, then Claudia.
Okay, on thank top. You.
I mean, number one, not on top. Bad wording.
Cindy, we have Dave's wife on the phone. Cindy?
Oh, I don't want this. This is no.
Cindy?
Yes?
Did you hear what Dave said, newlywed Dave, said about beautiful Larissa?
I did.
He said she was game. She could sit on his lap.
Jeez.
You'd be in the kitchen.
I like to, listen, I like to show off for my friends, but.
I know you do.
It's not about that, but right now Larissa and I are having a moment. Was it my bedroom eyes, Larissa?
Yes.
Listen, Cindy and I later tonight are having a party over at our place. It's a very private affair.
Is that right? And Larissa's invited?
You said you were into that.
Right.
Did you know I was invited?
I didn't, but. I mean, I can't blame her. I can't blame the girl, right?
Aww.
Let's have a Jello.
That was
let's
so
have
nice.
A, let's have Jello wrestling in here tomorrow. The fight for my heart.
Yeah.
That'll be fantastic. I can't wait.
All right, Cindy. Will you just fire up that crock pot full of ossobuco?
I leave and they can make up their own. No, it's a bad idea.
Sheck's going to be home to take a draw off the tap and talk hockey with you for about 9 hours before he eventually passes out.
That'll be fun for you.
Hey, one thing, quick thing, Cindy. Do you want to fight Larissa?
I mean, I could take her.
Ooh.
You probably could. I can't fight. I wouldn't fight back.
Certainly be worth watching.
No, let's not fight. Let's all love one another.
Yes. You guys love each other. I'll get the camera. Thank you, Cindy.
Hey, anytime.
All right, baby doll.
All right.
I'm a fan of hers. I've always been attracted to your wife. I got to be. I gotta be honest with you.
I see this going really bad.
Always attracted to her. I like petite, attractive, cute. It's her personality too. I swore I'd never let personality factor in.
What's happened?
Cloud my judgment. Right, but you know
gotta,
what?
We
I
gotta
really
get out of here because Carolla's gotta go get fake tan now.
Yeah, I gotta go get orange stuff sprayed on me, and then you see me tomorrow when I'm
Mr.
all
Hollywood.
Okay.
Yeah, when I look like Duran, and then you tell me if I'm number two.
Okay.
But you'd still bed me down, right, Larissa?
Yeah.
I mean, just as a potential move up in the company.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, me and Maury Povich. We are gonna take ourselves a little break. I want to give thanks for thanks. bags are due, iecoffee.com. They deliver all the coffee to us, all the coffee that Big Tad's supposed to be brewed by 6 a.m. and does it by 7:30 in the morning. iecoffee.com. It's a good cause. The guy's wife is sick. You'd really help out a guy. He doesn't want your charity. He wants your business. He provides a beautiful product. Sid Stein, a little on the side, wrote a book about cheating. Ooh, gonna need that, Damashek. Henry
putting
Phillips.
That in my pocket as we speak.
Yes, the CD, Why Haven't I Heard From You? Def Rat Guy, of course, Claudia DeFalco. Nice job, as usual, Claudia.
Thank you.
We'll be back tomorrow with another show. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying mahalo.